Good morning and welcome to the Justice Committee's 10th meeting of 2017. We have apologies from Oliver Mundell, and I'm pleased to welcome Alexander Stewart, who is attending as his substitute. Agenda item number one is declaration of interests. Alexander, do you have any interest to declare?
Thank you, Convener. Delighted to be here. And I am still a serving member on Perth and Kinross Council, and I sit on the Community Safety Committee until the 4th of May.
Thank you for that. Agenda item number two, subordinate legislation. This is consideration of the affirmative instrument on the Scottish Tribunals, Listed Tribunals, Regulations 2017. And I welcome to the committee Annabelle Ewing, Minister of Community Safety and Legal Affairs, along with her officials Hannah Frodsham, Policy Executive, Sandra Wallace, Policy Manager, and John Sinclair, Senior Principal Legal Officer with the Scottish Government. Can I refer members to paper number one, which is a note by the clerk, and paper two, which is the Scottish Government briefing note, and invite the Minister to make a brief opening statement.
Good morning. Thank you, Convener. The first SSI this morning is the Scottish Tribunals, brackets listed tribunals, close brackets, regulations 2017. These regulations remove the Crofting Commission from the listed tribunals, that is the list of tribunals in Schedule 1 of the Tribunal Scotland Act 2014. The list of tribunals in Schedule 1 of that Act was taken from a report by the former UK-wide body, the Administrative Justice and Tribunals Council, which listed those tribunals they considered to be devolved. The Administrative Justice and Tribunals Council was, before its abolition in 2013, required to keep the administrative justice system under review. During the bill stage of the Crofting Reform Scotland Act 2010, there was discussion about the Crofting Commission's status. Ministers at the time were minded not to remove it from the list of tribunals at that time so as to keep it within the supervisory remit of the AJTC. However, as I said, the AJTC was abolished in 2013, and the Tribunals Act does not include provision for a statutory body to have a supervisory role over the Scottish Tribunals. In the absence of a supervisory body, and given that the Crofting Commission is not a tribunal in the true sense of the word, it is considered that the Crofting Commission can now be removed from the listed tribunals list in Schedule 1 of the 2014 Act. And I'd be happy to answer any questions, Convener.
Thank you, Minister. Do members have any questions? John Finney.
Good morning, Minister. Are there any implications for day-to-day business of crofting, please, as a result of this proposal?
No, I can't see that. What I would say is that, in fact, we undertook a consultation on this SSI, and that was between 26 May and 24 June 2016. And we received seven responses. Six of the seven were content with the proposals. There was one response from our Crofting Law solicitor, Brian Inkster, and he felt that the Crofting Commission should be retained as a tribunal. And the main issue of concern that Mr. Inkster had was that with regard to the use of a particular section of the Crofters legislation, which allows the Crofting Commission to make an inquiry and then remove any or all of the members of a grazing committee from office. His concern is that there is no right of appeal to the Scottish Land Court, and therefore the only appeal is right of appeal is judicial review. He felt that if the Crofting Commission were to transfer into the Scottish Tribunals, then there would be an appeal to the upper tribunal. But for the reasons I've said, I mean, the Crofting Commission isn't a tribunal in any event in the true sense of the word. This was a kind of historical quirk that there was this mention of the Crofting Commission in the listed tribunals because of the role, the supervisory role at that time of the AJTC. In terms of our programme for government, the member will be aware that we will be bringing forward during the term of this Parliament crofting legislation. And in the context of that legislation, it may be that this issue in terms of the right of appeal will be brought to the forefront of debate. And obviously we will engage with stakeholders when we get to that stage.
Thank you, Minister. That's what I was going to ask. There's a lot of issues at the moment with crofting. And so why now with this? Why not wait? And does it substantially alter the relationship with the Land Court?
No, I mean, the reason that this is why now is because in 2013 the AJTC was abolished. We're moving to the implementation of the 2014 Act. We're looking at going forward having this statutory simplified framework in place. This is an anomaly that arose for the reasons I've stated, and therefore we felt it was timely now to deal with this anomaly. In terms of the daily workings of the Crofton Commission, this should make no difference because actually since 2013 there has been no supervisory role exercised in any event, and now of course for the Scottish Tribunal system it's the Lord President that sits at the head of that system. So on a day-to-day basis this should not make any significant substantive difference, but it is a tidying up exercise, and as we go forward with the crofting legislation over the term of this Parliament, the issue of the right of appeal will, I'm sure, be one that will be brought to the forefront of debate.
Thank you. And the relationship with the Land Court, does that change in any way?
It doesn't change as a result of this, no.
Okay, many thanks.
Stuart Stevenson.
It's just a simple little question in relation to the Scottish Tribunal structure as a whole. I just wonder if there are any other outstanding matters in relation to bringing existing bodies into the Scottish Tribunal structure that we might expect to see in due course?
It is planned that all the devolved tribunals will be brought within the Scottish Tribunal structure as set forth in the 2014 legislation, and there's a kind of timetable for the proposed implementation of that, and therefore we will proceed on that basis, and obviously that will be done by way of bringing to this committee the relevant SSIs for the committee's deliberations and consideration. I'm just looking at my papers because I think the next tribunal to be considered will be the assisted additional support needs tribunal, and that will be, I think, in the autumn that we will be hoping to bring the SSI to the committee. So there is a rolling programme in terms of devolved tribunals, and of course there's the position of the reserve tribunals, and that is further down the line as well.
Nothing further to add. Okay, do any members have any other questions? That being the case, we now move to agenda item number 3. This is formal consideration of the motion in relation to the affirmative instrument. The DPLR committee has considered and reported on this instrument and has no comment on it. The motion is motion 04152 that the Justice Committee recommends that the Scottish Tribunals, Listed Tribunals, Regulations 2017 draft be approved. Can I invite the Minister to speak and or move the motion?
I formally moved, Convener.
Formally moved. Do members have any further comments? That being the case, the question is that motion 04152 in the name of Annabelle Ewing be approved. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
We are agreed. That concludes consideration of the affirmative instrument. The committee's report will note and confirm the outcome of the debate. And can I have the committee's agreement to delegate to me as convener the authority to clear the final draft report? Thank you for that. Agenda item 4, subordinate legislation, is consideration of 4 affirmative instruments relating to the transfer of the Scottish tax tribunals to the Scottish tribunals structure. Because they are linked instruments, we are taking evidence on them together. And I refer members to paper 3, which is a note by the clerk, and paper 4, which is the Scottish Government's briefing note. And I again ask the Minister to make a short opening statement.
Thank you, Convener. This suite of fairly technical regulations will transfer the Scottish tax tribunals into the Scottish tribunal structure created by the Tribunal Scotland Act 2014. The first of the regulations before you today is the First Tier Tribunal for Scotland Tax Chamber and Upper Tribunal for Scotland Composition Regulations 2017. These regulations specify the type of member who will hear cases in the tax chamber. These provisions mirror the existing composition of the First Tier Tax Tribunal. This instrument also sets out the composition of the Upper Tribunal when hearing appeals from the First Tier Tribunal Tax Chamber. The regulations allow for a legal member of the Upper Tribunal or a Court of Session judge to hear an appeal in the Upper Tribunal. This again mirrors the previous arrangements. The President of Tribunals will determine who hears these appeals. The President may also select herself, the Chamber President, or indeed the Lord President if appropriate. The next instrument before you is the Tribunal Scotland Act 2014 Ancillary Provisions Regulations 2017. This instrument revokes Part 4 and Schedule 2 of the Revenue Scotland and Taxpayers Act 2014. These sections establish the Scottish Tax Tribunals and their procedures. The instrument also revokes 4 regulations which establish the Conduct and Fitness Assessment Tribunals, the time limits and rules of procedure for both the First Tier and Upper Tax Tribunals, the eligibility for appointment to the Scottish Tax Tribunals, and rules concerning voting and offences in proceedings. These are all covered by provisions in the Tribunals Act, so are no longer necessary. For brevity, Convener, I will summarise the last two regulations together. They are the First Tier Tribunal for Scotland, Transfer of Functions of the First Tier Tax Tribunal for Scotland, Regulations 2017, and the Upper Tribunal for Scotland, Transfer of Functions of the Upper Tax Tribunal for Scotland, Regulations 2017. These two regulations simply transfer the functions and members of the First Tier Tax Tribunal to the First Tier Tribunal for Scotland Tax Chamber, and the functions and members of the Upper Tax Tribunal to the Upper Tribunal for Scotland. In addition, the regulations set out the transitional procedure for cases that are in progress on the date of transfer. As the First Tier and Upper Tax Tribunals are listed separately in the Tribunals Act, each of the jurisdictions need to be dealt with in separate instruments. In conclusion, Convener, it is the case that each of these instruments plays a part in enabling the transfer of the tax tribunals to the new structure. Again, I'd be happy to take any questions.
Okay, do members have any questions for the Minister? No. That being the case, then we move to agenda item 5, which is a formal consideration of the motions in relation to the 4 affirmative instruments. The DPLR committee has considered and reported on these instruments and has no comment to make. Each motion will be moved with an opportunity for debate if that's necessary. And the first motion is motion 04151. That the Justice Committee recommends that the First Tier Tribunal for Scotland, Tax Chamber and Upper Tribunal for Scotland Compensation Regulations 2017 draft be approved. And I invite the Minister to speak to or move the motion.
Formally moved.
Thank you. Does any member have any comment to make? That being the case, the question is that motion 04151 in the name of Annabelle Ewing be approved. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
Thank you. The second motion is motion 04153, that the Justice Committee recommends that the Tribunal Scotland Act 2014 Ancillary Provisions Regulations 2017 draft be approved. Can I invite you, Minister, to move the motion?
Formally moved.
Thank you. Are there any questions from members? No. That being the case, the question is that motion 04153 in the name of Annabelle Ewing be approved. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
Thank you. The third motion is motion 04336, that the Justice Committee recommends that the First Tier Tribunal for Scotland, Transfer of Functions of the First Tier Tax Tribunal for Scotland Regulations 2017 draft be approved. Minister, can I invite you to move the motion?
Formally moved.
Thank you. Do members have any questions? That being the case, the question is that motion 04336 in the name of Annabelle Ewing be approved. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
The fourth and final motion is motion 04337, that the Justice Committee recommends that the Upper Tribunal for Scotland Transfer of Functions of the Upper Tax Tribunal for Scotland Regulations 2017 draft be approved. Minister, can I invite you to move the motion?
Formally moved.
Thank you. Do members have any questions? That being the case, the question is that motion 04337 in the name of Annabelle Ewing be approved. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
Thank you. That concludes consideration of these affirmative instruments. The committee's report will note and confirm the outcome of the debate on all 4 instruments. Is the committee content to delegate authority to me as convener to clear the final draft report?
Agreed.
Thank you. Thank you to the Minister and her officials for attending, and can we suspend briefly to allow for a change of officials? Agenda item six is our final evidence session of the Limitation Childhood Abuse Scotland Bill. I refer members to paper five, which is a note by the clerk, and paper six, which is a SPICE briefing paper. And I welcome back the Minister, who is accompanied by Eleanor O, Policy Manager, and Scott Matheson, Senior Principal Legal Officer with the Scottish Government. Minister, do you want to make an opening statement?
Yes, thank you, Convener, if I may. As the committee will be aware, over the past few years, there has been an increasing awareness of the blight of historical childhood abuse and the fundamental challenges that survivors have faced in getting recognition and support, including access to justice. You will also be aware that many survivors have campaigned long and hard for reform to the current limitation regime. The difficulties faced by survivors in accessing the civil justice system were clearly highlighted by the Scottish Human Rights Commission in their interaction process. Survivors have, I would say, been let down repeatedly. They were severely and fundamentally let down by their abuser and by the adults who were meant to protect them at the time. But I would also say that they have once again been let down by a justice system which has effectively denied them access to a remedy. I am therefore pleased to bring forward this bill, which will remove a barrier for survivors in accessing justice. This barrier, the three-year limitation period, has meant that survivors have had to justify to the court why they did not raise an action earlier, a process which has proved extremely stressful and degrading for many survivors. I have listened carefully to the previous evidence sessions. As the committee has noted, the bill is no panacea, and raising a civil action will not be the solution for all survivors. But the bill is about widening the number of options available to survivors and ensuring that they are not faced with an insurmountable barrier should they choose to raise a civil action. This bill is very much about striking a balance, and there have been a number of difficult issues that I have had to grapple with. These include the need to carefully consider the implications of the European Convention on Human Rights at every step of the process. It has also included striking a balance between being inclusive and at the same time seeking to avoid unintended consequences. The measures in the bill are intended to give the much-needed reboot to the system that one witness before you spoke about. At the same time, I have made every effort to ensure that the provisions in the bill are justified and are proportionate. As I'm sure we will discuss in more detail today, care has to be taken where this balance is struck. There is a real possibility that the aim of the bill will be undermined and the process severely frustrated should we upset this balance. Finally, I would just like to point out that this bill is part of a range of measures that the Scottish Government is taking forward for survivors of childhood abuse. As the committee will be aware, other measures include the Scottish Child Abuse Inquiry, the Survivor Support Fund, and also the consultation on financial redress. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Minister, for that opening statement. Stuart Stevenson.
Thank you very much, Convener. I suppose the first and obvious question is, why have a bill at all? And I ask that question in the context of what they chose to do in Jersey, where they established the Historic Abuse Redress Scheme, which was outside both the civil and criminal justice system. Now, of course, Jersey is a small jurisdiction. The problems were distinct and different in Jersey, so I don't map the one to the other. But I just wonder to what extent options short of actually legislating were considered and why they were not seen as the way forward for dealing with this injustice, which I think we all recognise is quite validly waiting to be addressed.
What I would say is that what we're looking at here is, as I said, the Scottish Government has taken a number of actions forward and is progressing a number of actions, one of which is the improvement in terms of access to justice through the civil law of our country, and an issue identified by the survivors themselves as being a barrier at the present time. And therefore, this is responding to a request from survivors that we look at specifically the limitation issue. In terms of the issue of a redress scheme, of course, we are in the process of ensuring that there will be engagement and consultation on financial redress for in-care survivors, and we expect that consultation to proceed in the months to come, and we'll carefully consider the submissions made, and that process is actually underway as we speak in terms of the work of CELSIS and the Interaction Action Plan Review Group in paving the way and ensuring engagement, including looking at the what we can learn from international experience. So that work is going on apace in terms of in-care survivors. But what we're looking at here is the civil law of Scotland. And whilst there is the possibility, in principle, of raising an action for reparation, we have seen that the hurdles that have to be overcome for these claimants has actually proved insurmountable. I think there has been one case where the discretion of the courts under the 1973 Act has been exercised. And that is, to me, not eminently not fair, because if we have a civil law system, we have to ensure that there is equal access to everybody to the remedies that are there. And that is, therefore, part of the suite of measures that the Scottish Government is pursuing to ensure that, finally, survivors of historic child abuse get the justice they deserve.
So, Minister, in essence, it boils down to that the operation of the Scottish legal system requires us to act and legislate to ensure that barriers that may not have existed in other jurisdictions of a similar kind, such as might have been the case in Jersey, without opening up too big a discussion on that subject, are why we are finding ourselves with primary legislation.
Yes, in terms of the need to ensure that under the civil law of Scotland that it is there for everybody and not just some people, that is why we have proceeded with legislation on limitation and responding to the wishes of the survivors and responding to the fact that this has been highlighted as a problem for some years now, and that is what we're responding to today with the limitation bill. The member asked in his first question about what alternatives the Scottish Government considered, because obviously this does raise issues in terms of the legal certainty, the finality of the law, the rights of the defender to have fairness under the legal system. And we did look at alternatives in terms of ascertaining whether or not there might be another way to reach the same objective. But we considered various things, I think, set out clearly in the policy memorandum to the bill. For example, we considered whether just having no limitation period at all for any action could be a possibility. And of course, that would, I think, fall foul of the European Convention. We considered whether we could extend the limitation period for all actions. But again, that met with resistance from other claimants. And also, it wouldn't really solve the problem that we have faced with survivors of historic childhood abuse. We considered whether window legislation, I think they've had that in the United States, could be appropriate, whereby you give a year window in which claims can be brought forward. But again, if you are not ready to raise your action in that window, that won't help you, nor will it help in terms of cases going forward when you revert back to the limitation period. Because for those people for whom limitation has been a problem because of the nature of the heinous abuse, the heinous behaviour, the heinous harm that is caught within this definition, then that won't help them either. So we have considered a number of alternatives, but for the reasons that we stated, as set forth in detail in the policy memorandum, we felt that they were not going to secure the objective sought, which is to remove this obstacle to justice on the part of survivors of childhood abuse.
Stewart has another line of questioning. Before we leave this one, I think if we've learned anything, if we heard a message loud and clear from the survivors that gave evidence, it was consult them in advance. Do I take it that there was no consultation about the Jersey scheme with survivors?
There's been a number of strands of work, and that's what I was trying to refer to in my opening statement. And in terms of the work on redress, there has been, as far as I'm aware, a number of conversations with survivors over a period of time. And in terms of the most recent conversations, the process being conducted now by CELSIS and by the Interaction Action Plan Review Group to make the necessary arrangements to pave the way for this consultation and then the engagement and then the consideration of the responses is something that has been put in place further to discussions with the survivors on this subject. So that has been a subject that has been... that survivors have had an opportunity to discuss. And of course, with the consultation that we expect to see in the months to come, obviously there will be a further opportunity to make detailed submissions to that consultation.
And the view of survivors therefore on the Jersey redress scheme?
Well, I wouldn't want to suggest that all survivors take the same view on all subjects, because that's not the case. But what I'm saying is, on the issue of financial redress, the Deputy First Minister announced that this was the way that we were intending to proceed after he has had conversations with survivors, and I think he wrote to the education convener just some weeks ago to confirm that that is how we were going to proceed. And obviously in the context of that process and the consultation, for those who feel that the Jersey model is the way forward, they will not hesitate in making their submissions known to that consultation and engagement process.
So it was part of wider discussions but not specifically consulted on?
There have been, as I say, wider discussions on financial redress and what the appropriate way is to take that forward. There are many instances of different approaches, and each of those will be something that those who consult to, those who make submissions to the consultation, will wish to bring forward, depending upon what they see as being most appropriate in the circumstances. And I'm sure that will include submissions on the Jersey model.
Stewart Stevenson.
Thank you very much. I want to turn to section 17C that's being inserted in the previous Act, which is on previous litigation. And in particular, to start off with, I have a number of questions. We've heard as a committee that there is no precedent for legislating away final determinations, and that's what the bill seeks to do. And I think clearly where we have a novel, and I think that word is not always a term of praise in these matters, a novel approach, we as a committee have to look at that very carefully. How has the government satisfied itself that removing, allowing previous determinations to be reopened by a couple of mechanisms is not going to fall foul of ECHR legislation in particular?
Yes, the member raises a very important question, and that actually informs our approach to the bill as a whole, because as I mentioned in the opening statement, we have had to, in this very complex area, strive to maintain this balance, which will allow us to fall on the right side of the ECHR and the Article 1, Protocol 1 provisions. And with respect to the issue of previously litigated cases, we did feel that not to include that as a possibility would create unfairness amongst different survivors, and that is why we have included that. But we do recognise, indeed, that that is very much in contradistinction to what has been accepted as the normal rules on finality. And therefore, that is why we have drafted carefully, or sought to draft carefully, the relevant provision in Section 17C, such that it will, in fact, be for the pursuer in the first instance to show that they had the reasonable belief that there had been a settlement which was agreed further to the action falling on the ground of limitation. And in the wider context, we believe that's fair, because there was no substantive, these are the circumstances where there has been no substantive adjudication on the merits, and that the case has fallen because of the application of the limitation rule. And with the onus being on the pursuer in the first instance to adduce this reasonable belief test, if you like, we feel that we have recognised that this is indeed a departure from previous practice, and that we have introduced this safeguard in that element of the process as far as previously litigated cases are concerned.
The Minister is talking about the pursuer having to show that it falls within the provisions in particular of A and B, and in particular B, I think 2B. and used the phrase personal belief. Is that an indication to us that omissions in the paper trail that might sustain this will not be a barrier to the personal belief being able to be demonstrated in a civil court, in the balance of advantage? Is that what the minister is seeking to say in using the phrase personal belief?
I should correct the record. I meant to use the phrase reasonable belief. One could do as a pursuer is, and we anticipate that that could involve a personal statement. I'm sorry, that was a shorthand. A personal statement by the pursuer to the effect that they did hold a reasonable belief that the case did not proceed because it came up against the hurdle, the insurmountable hurdle of the limitation, application of the limitation period, and that could be by way of a personal statement. Of course, what we're doing in this bill is changing the limitation rule as far as it applies to this class of cases. We're not changing the laws of reparation cases in general. The laws of reparation and all the court processes and the way that the court deals with balancing evidence and satisfying itself as to the position with respect to the facts and circumstances of each case before it will pertain. And therefore, there may well be an issue of records, but there may well be other ways in which that can be overcome. And it will depend on the facts and circumstances of each case.
So, Minister, that appears to confirm that if there were gaps in the paper record, that is not, in general terms, cases will vary case to case, is not in general terms a barrier to a case being taken under the provisions of this bill.
It wouldn't preclude in all circumstances, no, because you would be able to take the statement of the pursuer to the effect that they had reasonable belief that the case had fallen on the grounds of the limitation period, and it would be up to the court to, as master of the facts, to assess the facts and circumstances of that case and any evidence that was adduced or not, as the case may be, to take the view that they would take. Obviously, if the pursuer makes this statement as to reasonable belief, it will be up to the defender to seek to rebut sure. that in the way that you would with any claim and counterclaim in the court. So I'm trying to explain that it would not be, to answer the member's question, an insurmountable barrier in all cases. It would depend on the facts and circumstances. And the final thing to reiterate is that this bill seeks to take away the obstacle to justice that has been identified, in particular by survivors' groups. It does not change the law of reparation in Scotland in other respects. Therefore, that is an important consideration to remember, that the courts deal with very difficult issues of evidence, weighing up evidence and the balance of probabilities every day of the week, and they remain in place to do that with respect to these particular provisions of the limitation bill.
I'm sure that's going to be very helpful and useful words to have on the record. And the final point, Convener, is on the issue of excluding from having access to the rights under this bill whenever even a single pound has previously been paid in compensation. It does strike me personally as a non-lawyer that that seems to be rather unjust, in particular in that people previously may have felt they had no option but to settle, even though it was a nugatory amount that was being offered in compensation, because not to settle would simply be for the case they were then engaging in not to proceed, and for them not to get the emotional justice that came from settlement. What consideration has been given to whether that limitation of even that tiny nugatory amount, is that denying people justice in the terms, particularly, and the case I've used before is where you've identical twins in identical circumstances, one of whom settled, including a pound, and one of whom did not, now find themselves in a very different environment. What issues surround that particular decision, which is captured at section 4, 17C4, B and section 5.
Yes, this is a very difficult issue and one that I have a great deal of sympathy with. However, what we have tried to do, and that's what I was trying to emphasise in my opening statement, is what we have tried to do is to strike the balance between proceeding with what is a major change in the law of Scotland in terms of removal of the limitation period for this class of claim, And that balance of the defender's rights and the finality of the law and legal certainty. So we have sought and striven very, very hard to have this fine balance in the legislation, in the bill. And we feel that we therefore have to have draw a dividing line somewhere. And this is where the dividing line is drawn in terms of the provisions in the bill. And I do sympathise, but what we are saying really is in effect that because, in terms of including previously litigated cases, what we're saying is the key thing here is that there has been no substantive consideration of the merits and in effect no compensation payable. So whilst, you know, in a case where there has been no expenses due to or by, or in a case where there has been expenses paid, that is not putting the pursuer in a better position, even if marginal, than they were in, if they had not raised the proceeding. And that is the fundamental difference. We are not saying that all cases which had previously been litigated can be subject to this consideration of whether or not they can be looked at again. We are saying that those where there has been no substantive adjudication on the merits, those that have fallen because of the application of the limitation period, it is those cases that the victims, the pursuer, will be entitled to seek to have brought before the court. And we do have to draw this line somewhere. Now, in the evidence, I think, from memory, one of the people giving evidence was a lawyer who has acted for defenders in some 400 or 500 cases, and they made the point, if I'm remembering this correctly, that actually in their experience, this scenario is not really very likely to have taken place, in that there would have been no incentive for the defender to make even a nominal payment in excess of expenses, and that in most cases, in any event, they would have been settled on the basis of no expenses due to or by. So whilst I accept that it's not without any possibility that there could be some instance of this, the feeling on the part at least of this lawyer who had acted for hundreds of defenders was that this actually is not something that would have happened as a matter of course in practice.
Can I just finally, just because you kind of raised something that I hadn't thought of, that is it not the case that there can be an initial action disposed of by the court in accordance with a relevant settlement, but without evidence having been led? And therefore, you sort of seem to suggest to me, as a layperson, I emphasise once again, that a settlement would only have been reached where a determination of on the evidence has been reached.
Well, that's quite what I'm trying to explain, is that actually the previously litigated cases, that the only ones that could potentially fall within the scope of this bill would be ones that did not involve a substantive adjudication on the merits. And that is the key point, because the pursuer, the victim, did not get the opportunity of their day in court, if you like to use that cliched phrase. They didn't get the opportunity of that because there was no substantive adjudication of the merits. They didn't get to that stage because the case fell at the hurdle of the limitation period applicability, and that they weren't able to persuade the court to exercise its discretion to actually lift the application of the three-year limitation period. And in fact, I understand that I think there's been one instance where the court has so proceeded in the last 40 years or something, so it shows that there has been, as a matter of practice, this barrier to access to justice on the part of these victims.
Can I just say I'm going to have to read the official report because I'm not entirely convinced by this, and I reserve the right to pursue it further if
of course, and if the member wishes to write to me, then.
Indeed, I may do that. Convener.
Liam MacArthur, follow-up.
Good morning. Just following on from that, we'll come to the issue of the discretion open to the court under 17D, but specifically on 17C, obviously there is the degree of dismissal and the degree of absolvitor that is referred to in previously dealt with cases. I think some concern has been raised by a number of witnesses about what we described as the innate conservatism of the judiciary in relation to the way in which it exercises its discretion now. Is there a view that you have, or that is borne out by the evidence that you've taken on extending this right in relation to degree of absolvitor, that gives you confidence that the judiciary would not simply take a view that anything that falls within that category simply will be dismissed out of hand? Because there were certainly more clear concerns from the witnesses we've heard from around that aspect mm-hmm. of 17C than there was particularly in relation to decree of dismissal.
Yeah, I know that I've seen that that is the case, that there has been a number of questions on this point. I mean, I think it's important to remember, and it's maybe something that has been kind of lost in this debate, that the decree of absolvitor is not necessarily always going to be the appropriate decree simply where there has been a substantive consideration. Decree of absolvitor can also happen in circumstances where there has been no substantive consideration. I think people's assumption is that the decree of absolvitor will only come into play in circumstances where a case is disposed of further to a substantive consideration of the merits, and that is not always the case, and therefore, again, this gets back to the facts and circumstances examination of the court before whom this action would be brought for consideration of removal of the time bar, and they would have to look into the facts and circumstances. As I was trying to make clear to Mr. Stevenson, further to his questions, in the key dividing line here is if there has been a substantive consideration of the merits, then you will not be able to use this bill to reopen the case, because that would be an infringement of the ECHR that we could not find any justification for. It is cases where there has been no such substantive consideration of the merits, whether settled by a decree of dismissal or decree of absolvitor, because it is competent to grant a decree of absolvitor even where there has been no consideration.
I think that came through in the evidence. Okay. I'm thinking more that the inclination of courts in relation to decree of absolvitor may be that that has a particular significance mm-hmm. that, notwithstanding what you've said, they are more reluctant to kind of reopen, if you like, and that in effect, this will simply be dismissed, notwithstanding the reassurances you've given.
Yeah, Eleanor, could you maybe explain a bit more of the background and the work that we did on that?
Yes, and, absolutely. I think that's a very good point. And I guess we cannot predict how the court will react in these cases. However, I guess the bill creates a default position, which the intention for the default position is for these cases to be allowed to be reopened. And actually, because that is the default position, we are then, the bill sets out a position where actually you would need to point to something quite specific and something which is above and beyond the default position for these cases not to go ahead. And I guess the intention is for the courts to then interpret it in that way, that there would have to be something specific. And as you've seen as well in the drafting of the bill, it's not just the possibility of prejudice. You have to point to something which is the real substantial prejudice or real evidence of there being not possible to have an unfair trial. So while we completely recognise that there is a danger, we can't predict it. I think the bill still sets the level of what the default position is, and defenders would have to show something which is above and beyond that default position.
Can I just look at this a little bit more, because it is one of the more probably contentious issues within the bill. We're looking here at substantive law, and in effect this overturns the legal principle of res judicata, which would be a legitimate expectation that such cases that had already been looked at, even if they hadn't been brought to trial, but had been kind of considered, wouldn't be overturned. Now, I appreciate what the minister's saying. They may not have actually got their day in court. And the assumption is, therefore, that the decree of absolvitor would be overturned on the assumption that, on the assertion that this was being done because it was going to be time-barred, and instead of getting me a decree of dismissal, the insurance companies were seeking absolvitor to make sure it wasn't raised again. Now, I have to say, when we took evidence from the representatives of the insurance companies, they didn't recognise this, and I think there was some concern about how we would the reasonable belief test would work in practice. So what discussions have there been with the insurance companies? And the two people that appeared before us, ABI and FOIL, didn't recognise this scenario at all. But the minister says it's been identified by some survivors. Could you perhaps elaborate on that a little bit?
Well, I mean, the issue of of there being insurmountable obstacles to a survivor's case going through to the next stage have been identified by survivors. The issue of the decree of absolvitor, I mean, I think if it was called something else, it wouldn't be causing this confusion, because I think the element of the confusion derives from the fact that people assume that a decree of absolvitor is only granted after there has been a substantive consideration of the merits. That is not the case. The decree
I'm going
of
to interrupt absolvitor you there. The point's been made to Liam. He's understood it. I think the committee have understood it. But this is a particular niche, as I understand it, that the government is legislating for. And that's where the assumption is, or the assertion is, that the decree absolvitor was granted and agreed to, or sought by the insurance company and agreed to by the pursuer, because they had no expectation of any other legal address because the case would be time barred. Is that?
Well, in essence, the expectation is that it was granted on the basis that the case couldn't proceed because of time bar, and that instead of the disposal being by decree of dismissal, it was, for whatever reason, by decree of absolvitor. It's a procedural point, but as you rightly say, the underlying issue is that the case came to that point because the feeling was that it wouldn't go through because of time bar. And that is why we have included that, because of course it is a procedural point, and if you are the person in the position who has not been able to pursue their claim because of the failure of the time bar, the limitation approach to these cases, and with the discretionary safeguard which hasn't actually been invoked more than on one occasion, so if you are a pursuer in that position, it would seem to you that it would be unfair not to include these cases as well, which have fallen on the same grounds, which is the application of the limitation rule. And if these were not included, there would be a perception of unfairness to that group of claimants. And that's why we have included that within these provisions, which, as I say, in terms of the previously litigated cases, the onus is on the pursuer to show the court that they had the reasonable belief that the settlement, be it by way of decree of dismissal, be it by way of decree of absolvitor, but that the settlement that I was arrived at was done on the basis that, in effect, look, you might as well just stop this because you're not going to get to the next stage because of the applicability of the limitation rule. And that is the kind of underlying key principle.
So how can you possibly prove that? Or are we just turning this entirely on its head and saying any decree absolvitor granted where the case would have been time barred is automatically assumed to come under this provision?
The underlying purpose here, I think it's always, I always go back to first principles, the underlying purpose here is to say to people who have not had access to justice because of the applicability of the limitation period, which albeit has a discretionary lift, which has not been exercised for this group of claimants. I think we have seen evidence to that effect. So it is to say to this group of claimants, well, okay, what can we do to ensure that you have access to justice? What we are doing is we are introducing this bill going forwards. We are introducing this bill with retrospective effect for cases after abuse after 26 September 64. And also we are allowing the consideration of whether it would be equitable in all the circumstances for previously litigated cases to be looked at again. And in those circumstances, it is those cases that have fallen because of the limitation period, i.e. where there was a settlement, a reasonable belief on the part of the pursuer, which could be a personal statement in the court to that effect, that the case settled because of the limitation period, and that cases, to go back to Mr. Stevenson's earlier point, where there has been no financial compensation received by the pursuer. So those are the key principles, and we felt that it would be unfair to exclude from that approach a limited set of cases which were settled with a decree of absolvitor, which is a procedural decision rather than a decree of dismissal, because it's the same set of key facts, if you like, underlying that settlement. And that is why we have included that. Scott, did you want to come in with a legal clarification?
I saw the previous evidence session where there was some discussion with the insurance company about the kind of origin of how these cases ended up being absolved. And I guess from a policy point of view and the way we've developed the bill, it doesn't quite matter exactly how they ended up being decree of absolvitor, because the point is, if there's a link between them being at a decree of absolvitor and the fact that they would have failed on limitation, it doesn't matter exactly how, what the process and who proposed what, because the point is they failed because of limitation. And that's the clear link in terms of which cases should be allowed to go ahead. It's not any case, it's the one where you can show and demonstrate the link to failing on limitation. So and we have had discussions with insurance companies on a range of issues, but perhaps not on that particular point. But I think the key thing is linking the failure of why you absolved to the fact that it was likely to be failed on limitation. That's the policy background.
So really, the reasonable belief test, it would be satisfied by a statement by the pursuer to the effect that that was their belief.
It could be, and it would be, in the end of the day, a matter for the court, who is the master of the facts, to decide on the facts and circumstances of the case and the evidence being adduced before that court, what view that they took on that.
Douglas Ross.
I've been trying to get in since the start, so if I can go back a little bit to the choice of language from the Minister in her opening remarks. And she said, survivors have been let down by the justice system itself. Was that a criticism from a Scottish Government Minister against judges not using this discretion?
I think it's a fair statement to say that the survivors have been let down by the justice system collectively. And in terms of the legislation, judges can only deal with the legislation that is before them. So the applicability of a limitation period is, in the end of the day, a matter of policy for the relevant government of the day. They have the 73 Act, and the policy really emanating from the 73 Act, and that is the parameters within which they must proceed, and that is the way in which they have proceeded. And if you have a limitation period, then effectively that will be the norm, and then there may be a provision for an exception, but the norm will be that you apply a limitation period. Other jurisdictions, for example, in Australia, the Royal Commission, which reported in 2015, took the view that it wasn't actually appropriate to have limitation periods applicable for this class of claimants. And I and the Scottish Government agree with that, because what you see is the creation of an inbuilt resistance to those cases actually proceeding, and I think that is what we have seen. So the judges acted within the legislation which is applicable, which is the 1973 Act.
Yeah. But it is a criticism from you that they were let down by the justice system itself. That was the words that I wrote down. And the fact that you have cited only one case where the discretion was used, why had it not been used? You said they've had this power. It's not as if they had no powers at all. So why had that discretion not been used? And why now in 2017 have you been forced to come forward with this legislation?
Well, as I say, if you have a limitation period applicable to, in this instance, this class of cases, then there will be the application of that limitation period. In terms of the exercise by the judges of the discretion, that is a matter obviously for judges, but they have to operate within the policy provisions emanating from the piece of legislation in hand, and that is the 1973 Act. I mean, I and the government believe that actually this is a unique set of circumstances that these cases present. So the nature of the abuses, we'd all agree, absolutely abhorrent. The position of the victim is the incredible vulnerability of the victim, because they are a child at the time, and we also have seen through various studies over the years the effect of abuse on children. It is this all-encompassing effect on children, the silencing effect, the fact we've seen in some studies where the average period of time cited for victims coming forward could be some 22 years. So in all the circumstances, we feel that a limitation period in and of itself is not appropriate and will cause problems for people accessing justice in these circumstances, because, as I say, it creates an inbuilt resistance to these cases actually proceeding. And that is why we are bringing forward the legislation that is before the committee today.
I'm just not getting from you what I was hoping to in terms of what has been done up until this point to see if the judges required further clarification to their powers, if they required further powers. You're taking forward legislation now, which is quite an overt step to overcome these problems. But since 1973, I think we've had one example of the discretion being used. So what action had the Scottish Government taken in the intervening periods, in your 10 years in office, for your party, since devolution, etc., to overcome the problem, which was clearly apparent if it had only been used once in over 30 years?
Well, certainly, as far as the SNP in government, I mean, we have been proceeding with a number of steps since we took office in terms of ensuring that for survivors that they get the support that they should have been having years ago. And that includes with respect to access to a remedy in court and includes many other strands which are referred to. So, for example, work has gone on a piece by the Scottish Human Rights Commission. I'm sure the member is aware of that and the report. And also the Scottish Law Commission has looked at the issue of limitation period. Their conclusion was that if there were problems, one could seek to go down the discretionary guidance route. But for the reasons I've stated, I don't feel that that will lead to a meaningful, significant solution to the problem aired particularly by survivors because, as I say, the existence of a limitation period in and of itself does create an inbuilt resistance to these cases proceeding. And that is why I believe that we have to remove the limitation period for this unique class of claimants.
Okay. Could I go on to something you said in your previous answer, that this legislation is important because of the vulnerability of the victim because they were a child at the time. Do you think then it's right that, say, for example, a 19-year-old with a mental age of under 18 should be exempt from this limitation?
Well, in terms of the general limitation rules, they don't apply while there is a period of unsoundness of mind. So the limitation period doesn't run whilst there's a period of unsoundness of mind.
That's
to deal with that issue. But
For clarity on that, is that for them bringing forward a claim or if they were a mental age when they were abused? That's the point I'm trying to get at.
The time limit doesn't apply doesn't run during the period of time where, for example, you weren't aware of the harm suffered, if industrial disease, for example, but with respect to the specific issue of unsoundness of mind, it doesn't run during the period of unsoundness of mind. So the limitation period doesn't run during that period. So that is the position as of the current time. But with regard to the definition of a child under the legislation, we have thought about this carefully, but we took the view that the prevailing definition, if you like, if we look at the Children's Scotland Act 1995, if we look at the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child, it is 18. And we did feel that because of the nature of the impact of abuse on a child, that to exclude 16 and 17-year-olds was not appropriate in the circumstances.
Sorry, that's not my question. What I'm saying is if you have someone who is 19 or 20 or 30, but at the time they were abused, they had a mental age of under 18, so they were effectively a child, and that could be diagnosed and could be confirmed, they will not be able to use this legislation to bring forward a claim, despite the fact that their vulnerability of having a mental age of under 18, which is something you've said twice now in your evidence, is a key driver to bring this forward. They would not be able to use this because their actual age is above 18, despite their mental age being below 18, and therefore they are vulnerable.
Deemed to be a vulnerable adult, but as I say, the limitation period doesn't apply during the period of unsoundness of mind, and perhaps Eleanor could clarify in terms of the position for any carer or guardian or whatever to act or intervene on their behalf.
So the concept of a mental age as a child sounds similar to the kind of lacking capacity to attend to your affairs, which is the concept of unsoundness of mind. So although our bill wouldn't be relevant, but the limitation regime as a whole would, or the limitation period wouldn't apply to them under Section 17.3 of the current regime. So if you have a mental age of a child and you lack capacity to deal with your own affairs, you're exempt anyway from the limitation period.
Yes, but you could progress with your mental age. You don't maintain that mental age of a child indefinitely in some cases. Therefore, the point I'm trying to get at is a group of people who have a mental age of under 18 and are abused because they are vulnerable because of that, or were abused years ago, who want to bring a claim, perhaps bring a claim themselves. So if they do that, people would say, well, they are not included in the limitations because they have the ability to bring forward a claim themselves. You are saying under this legislation, they wouldn't be able to bring forward that claim because the age in which they were abused, their physical age, was above 18. But they may now have the mental capacity to bring forward a claim, but they wouldn't be allowed to under this legislation.
It is to do with vulnerable adults and unsoundness of mind. It's the definition of a child is the definition of a child, and that's the legal definition. But as Eleanor said, The limitation period doesn't apply during periods of unsoundness of mind. Now, if this person that you refer to in your question, your hypothetical question, if that person did recover their mental capacity, then the limitation period would run from the time which they recovered their mental capacity.
Like Mr. Stevenson, I'll reserve my right to come back to that issue.
Okay.
Could I ask on the Minister's opening remarks as well? She said the aims of the bill could be threatened if we upset the balance. Could you explain that further, what you were alluding to with that?
So, and I've tried to kind of come back to that fundamental principle in my subsequent answers to members' questions thus far this morning, and that is to say that we do recognise that this is a major departure from Scots law principles thus far, and I have set out why I do feel in the circumstances that this is justifiable. This is a unique set of circumstances for this class of claimants. I do feel that it's therefore pursuing a legitimate aim. I do feel that what we are proposing is proportionate, and I do feel that we have looked at other possible routes but found them wanting in different regards. So we have kind of conducted the Human Rights Convention test, if you like, in advance to try to proof this legislation. And therefore, I do feel that the balance that we have struck between recognising that this is a major departure from the hitherto established principles of Scots law, but recognising the legitimate policy aims that underpinned the legislation, but also recognising the position of the defender, that we have, with the drafting, the careful drafting of these provisions, tried to strike this balance. And it is this balance we feel that is very important that will ensure the integrity of the bill should there be any subsequent attempts to undermine that. So we feel that this balance is carefully crafted, one element versus the other, the different strands of the bill, and that is the point I was trying to make.
And my final couple of points, if I can, if we can move on to some of the other evidence we've...
I'll come back to you, Douglas, because there are follow-ups from the line of questioning that you were pursuing, Fulton.
Yeah. Thanks, can and then a point.
Briefly, please.
Douglas Rossi's earlier line of questioning. And I'm just wondering, around the whole area of why the legislation has been brought forward now, and I'm just wondering if the Minister would agree that the reason that the Scottish Government are bringing forward the legislation now is at least in part due to the significant change in social attitudes towards this type of abuse, you know, high-profile cases that have been in the media, worker survivors groups, and a breakdown, really, of the taboo and the social attitude around it. I wonder if the Minister believes that the Scottish Government are responding to that. And I think we all agree it's the right thing to do for survivors.
Yeah, I did try to list a number of actions that have actually been taken since the late 2007, 2008, 2009, 2010, Human Rights Commission's involvement, the interaction process, very important process. Survivors feeling that they would get a hearing, that they would be listened to, and that, of course, I would imagine, reflects other developments in society at large, that they do feel now that it is the time that they can make some progress, and I pay all credit to them because, of course, it is a very, very difficult thing. I think we all appreciate for them to make their views known, to lobby on this subject, and I think we all want to work with them. So I think there have been a number of different developments over the years, and I think that all has led to this being the absolute right time that we should get on and take away this obstacle for survivors to access justice. As I've said, it's not a panacea. I think you've heard evidence that you still have to go through the normal court processes in terms of reparation and all the rest of it, but I think by this legislation, we at least remove one barrier, and I think that is important to ensure that survivors who have called for this feel that they are being listened to in this regard.
I just wanted to get clarity. Section 17 of the 1973 Act, point decimal 3, says, in computation of the period, legal disability by reason of non-age or unsoundness of mind is to be disregarded. So therefore, the category of people that we've been talking about have already got the rights to set the normal limitations to one side, and that this bill is about creating that right for a new class of people and is not required for people who, by reason of non-age or unsoundness, they already have such a right.
Yes, to be brief, I can see the convener is keen to keep to her schedule. In brief, that is the position. This is, for people in those categories, the limitation period, the clock is stopped and doesn't start again until capacity or until you are not in the position of non-age. With respect to survivors of historic abuse, we have seen that they simply cannot progress because of the limitations inbuilt into this limitation period, the inbuilt resistance to cases proceeding, and this is what we need to tackle, and this is what this legislation is designed to do.
Right, Douglas, you one other line of questioning before we move to Mary, Rona, Mary, John, so could you be brief, please?
Yeah, could I just ask, what is your prediction on the numbers coming forward? Because as a committee, we've seen a variety of different figures quoted, some significantly lower, some significantly higher. And given those numbers, which you will hopefully give the committee your best estimate, do you think the court process, the court system is adequately equipped to process these claims in a timorous manner for the people who want justice as soon as possible?
Yes, so I would refer the member to the financial memorandum that is part of the committee papers, and we have tried to come up with a best estimates position, a best estimates indicative figure, and the methodology is set quite clearly in the financial memorandum, and the mid figure that we have come up with is 2,200. Now, of course, nobody knows if that is going to be the exact figure or not, if it's going to be higher, if it's going to be lower, and I think the evidence before the committee has shown that we're simply not in a position to scientifically determine the exact figures involved. I think it is also fair to say that for many survivors, this route is not the route that will be right for them, and that is a matter of individual choice and informed choice. And it would be absolutely wrong of me as Minister to suggest that anybody should take a particular course of action. That is entirely for the survivor. So it may well be that in terms of figures that other people have quoted, that they're not taking into account the fact that this will not be the route that every survivor chooses to go down. So we have made our best estimates effort to come up with a figure, and that is the figure, the 2,200 referred to in the financial memorandum. With respect to the member's question about the court system, I think it is important to state also that we don't expect all of these cases to be raised simultaneously. We don't expect them all to be raised in the same court. We don't expect all the cases to proceed at the same rate. There will be different issues and different disposals at different times. So again, in the financial memorandum, we set out what we felt was a reasonable estimate in terms of the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service and the impact on them and their business. And that, again, I would refer the member to the financial memo for the detail of that, because they had different cost estimates, or there were different cost estimates applied to each of 5 years, because we felt that was a reasonable period of time to consider. And the final point I would make is, obviously, we will always be in touch with the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service, and I'm sure that they won't hesitate to alert us to any particular issues that may arise. And obviously, in terms of normal budgetary considerations, we will keep these matters under advisement.
That's useful to get on the record, because clearly we've read the financial memorandum, which you've said has come to a midpoint figure of about 2,200, yet our evidence suggests that there's one Glasgow law firm that has 1,000 survivors on their list alone, one firm in Glasgow, who are ready to bring forward action should there be a change in law. So the 2,200 figure quoted by the government does seem slightly low, considering there's one law firm has half of that ready to go if there is a change in law. But the final point the Minister made there, that she will listen to any concerns coming from the Scottish Court and Tribunal Service, I presume that means if this bill is passed and the legislation is implemented, if survivors start to come to MSPs, start to come to this committee to say, we were given these reassurances, we have waited a long time for this legislation, if they start to feel they are not being seen quickly enough, if the justice system is not treating them as a priority, we can take from the Minister for Community Safety that the government will view favourably any request for increased funding to meet the needs of a more burdened court system because of this?
Well, we always keep under advisement what is going on in our courts. But I would also maybe point out to the member that in terms of the one direct impact on the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service concerns the issue of fees. And of course, we have moved to 100% full cost recovery. And of course, that should be borne in mind in terms of looking at any financial impact on the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service in terms of their own resources. But as I say, I mean, we do expect that we will see actions raised in various share of courts, not just in the new personal injury court. The Court of Session is an option, of course, for cases over a particular threshold. We don't, as I say, anticipate that all potential victims will choose this route, because for them, it is up to them absolutely to decide what is the most appropriate way in which they wish to proceed, and I wouldn't prejudge that for a second. So we have come up with the best estimates figure, and of course we will continue very closely to monitor the situation as it goes forward.
And finally on funding, do you think local authorities and third sector organisations have adequate resources to meet the burden that they will face in terms of investigating and defending any of these claims made against them?
Of course, I've seen representations, in particular from COSLA to the committee. And of course, again, I think it is clear that actually at this point in time, nobody can say definitively what the impact will be across the piece. So I think we again keep these matters under advisement. I would confirm to the committee that we have been discussing matters with COSLA. Officials met with COSLA, I think, last week or just thereby. I am shortly to meet with the spokesperson on children and young people. I would say that I did actually, through officials, offer to meet with COSLA last autumn, but that didn't get picked up. But I'm happy to meet with them. Officials continue to meet, and we will keep this matter carefully under advisement. And at this stage, I think it is a bit premature to discuss any particular figures, because nobody knows, and I think we have to wait and see what the figures are. Yeah,
but we can take some comfort. We could see quite clearly that the issues raised by COSLA are being addressed by the Scottish Government.
Well, we're certainly in conversation with COSLA, but we have to see what happens. And it may be that for some councils, of course, there may not be any particular impact at all. So I think it's variables. I would say to Mr. Ross, there are so many variables here. I think that's been recognised in the evidence that has been given to the committee. There are so many variables. We simply are not in a position to bring out a crystal ball today. But we, as a responsible government, will continue to engage with COSLA, and of course those discussions will continue during the passage of the bill, and hopefully, if the bill passes, thereafter.
Mary, if you have brief supplementary.
Yes, thank you. Very brief, and it follows on the back of the last question that Douglas Ross asked, and it's about support, because not only could there be a potential burden on local authorities, but the support services that victims use may require additional support. And what we don't want is to be in a position where people come forward after waiting years and years. They may well have been supported, but they may need additional support. So is there enough flexibility, and are you alive enough to ensure that the correct supports are put in place around people as their cases may come to court?
I think that's a very important question. Obviously, there is the in-care survivor support fund. I think it's the Future Pathway Fund, and there is funding available under that heading for a number of activities. I think it is important that we ensure that the court system will be, in terms of looking at the issue from the perspective of a survivor and the support that they may need in terms of, for example, giving evidence as a vulnerable witness or whatever, that is well recognised. And I understand that we have been in discussions with the Scottish Court and Tribunal Service in broad brush on issues of support at court. I think we have also had discussions with the Law Society of Scotland to see, for example, whether they could instigate specialist training for lawyers, or perhaps even set up a specialist accreditation for this area of work. So we are very mindful of the point that Minifee raises, because as Minifee rightly says, it would be a very empty gesture indeed to provide the possibility of a legal remedy on the one hand, but on the other hand, not to recognise that there are very serious practical issues involved in this as well.
Thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you, Convener. Just to go back to, you mentioned a bit earlier about the definition of child in the bill, and it was really to talk about some of the other the key definitions that we have. And I think from asking some of the other panels that we'd had, I think everybody was in general agreement about that, the definition of child. But there was a lot of discussion over the definition of abuse as it currently sits in the bill. So it was really just to hear your comments in terms of some of the evidence that we've heard. We heard from some groups that they thought it should be more prescriptive in how it's described. Others welcomed the fact that it was it could be interpreted more broadly. For example, one definition that was raised by the Scottish Human Rights Commission was that of neglect, and they asked that that be specifically mentioned. So it was just really to get your comments on that, and is that something you would consider inserting into that definition?
Okay, yes, the issue of definition, I've noted a number of the submissions made on that point. Again, this goes back to the first principles of the balance of the Act and the delicate balance we've sought to arrive at. And of course, some people have said the definition's too wide, some people have said it's too narrow, and we have tried to get to some place that is going to protect the integrity of the bill by not taking it too far away from what the core principles for this that justify us taking this action in the first place. In terms of the issue of emotional abuse, and in terms of also the way that we have drafted this so that this is an inclusive list, sexual, physical and emotional abuse is an inclusive list and not a definitive list. And we feel that that is important because, of course, we can't begin to imagine all the forms of abuse that have been that these people have suffered at the hands of the perpetrators. We just can't begin to imagine all the kinds of abuse that could be viewed as this representation of this heinous, abhorrent harm. And therefore, I feel that we have to have this approach that we let the courts, who I think the Scottish Human Rights Commission it was who said that the Scottish courts are well placed to make these assessments. They make assessments every day of the week, and they're well placed to do that. The issue of emotional abuse, I think it's important to recall also that in terms of existing legislation in Scotland, for example, the Matrimonial Homes Family Proceedings Scotland Act dating back to 1981, that includes also the possibility of mental injury. And I think, again, the courts have had a considerable period of time to get to grips with that. So I feel quite confident that we have got the balance right. On the important issue of neglect, that was in the draft bill that we consulted upon, and the comments we got back, many of them suggested that that could take us too wide, that could lead to unintended consequences. And what I would say is that, in my view, the definition as it stands does not per se exclude neglect, but it would only include neglect that was not negligent, but amounted to this abusive behaviour, and that again would be the court that would make that assessment. So I do feel that we have got this balance right, but obviously I have looked at the evidence submitted, and I will read the committee's stage one report with interest on the subject.
Thank you. It was just on that point of neglect, because certainly from the Scottish Human Rights Commission, when they spoke to the committee, they said that, that it is quite, has quite a clear definition in itself. And obviously, I understand what you're saying about how emotional abuse can encapsulate a lot of the other types of abuse that were mentioned, and that was certainly recognised by some of the other submissions that we had as well. But, for example, we also had the term spiritual abuse raised and psychological abuse too. So it was really just to hear what you think about that. And again, is that something you consider just falls under that emotional abuse bracket and should be left as it is, or again, is that something that you would consider including?
I would take the view that, and I think it was the Law Society of Scotland and their evidence, and also the Scottish Human Rights Commission, and they both took the view that actually on the issue of spiritual abuse, which is a very interesting discussion, a non-defined concept, but an interesting discussion nonetheless, that could fall within emotional abuse. And in terms of psychological abuse, psychological harm, I do feel that most certainly could fall within the definition of emotional abuse. And I have cited the Matrimonial Homes Act of 1981, where mental injury is a feature. So I feel that the courts are really, as masters of the facts, well able, and the Scottish Human Rights Commission recognise that, to make these determinations, to get to the key issue here, which is justifying this departure from the normal law of Scotland in this instance, which is that the abuse is of such a heinous nature as perpetrated on somebody who was an incredibly vulnerable person, a child, and that the effect of that abuse, which has been well documented, means that you will not necessarily be in a position for years and years and years even to acknowledge that the abuse has happened. It is that level of seriousness which we are trying to get at. But again, we do not want to be too prescriptive because we can't imagine, I don't think, all the possible kinds of harm that could have been perpetrated, including, I think, for example, on the neglect side, children being told that nobody wanted them. So we don't know all the kinds of heinous behaviour that could have gone on, and we have to have a definition that doesn't close off or shut down a survivor's possible access to justice. And I think we have the balance right, but I will obviously look carefully at all the committee's deliberations on that point.
Okay, thank you.
I think that is very much appreciated by the committee, because there was a feeling when we took evidence that emotional didn't quite cover the spiritual aspect, where there was an indoctrination and it went a little bit further, almost onto the psychological, and perhaps neglect could come under that too, that there may be a case for having that on the face of the bill. So I think the committee very much welcomes the minister's open mind on this particular aspect. Rona?
Thank you. Good morning. I wonder if I could raise the issue of relevant settlements and just ask for a bit of clarification. The Forum of Insurance Lawyers has said that the burden of proving that there is a relevant settlement for the purposes of Section 17C would rest with the person raising the action, while the Law Society thought it rests with the defender. So I'm just wondering, who's right, in your opinion, and do you think that needs to be clarified within the legislation?
Well, as I said earlier, I think it's quite clear that in terms of the possibility for the court to look at previously litigated cases, so the issue where a settlement will come into place, it is for the pursuer in the first instance to show that they had the reasonable belief that the previous action settled on the basis of the applicability of the limitation period. And that, I think, is quite clear. I did note that the Law Society seemed to have a question, but I was a bit curious as to why they did, because it seemed to me quite clear on the face of the bill that that's where the onus would lie as regards that issue. But stating again for the record that as the pursuer, they have to show that they held a reasonable belief. Now, they could do that by, for example, giving a personal statement. And, of course, then it would be up to the defender to seek to rebut that, and that, again, would get you back into the normal rules of operation of the court in terms of the balancing of evidence. But in the first instance, it certainly would be for the pursuer, because this is, yet again, a major departure, if you like, from the applicable civil law of Scotland, and we have to be very mindful of that as far as the application of the European Convention rights, etc., are concerned.
Thank you. Yes, I mean, I was confused too as a layperson about why the Law Society thought that it would rest with the defender, because that seems to turn the system around in its head. So you can't really offer any reason why they would have thought.
Imagine that the committee might wish to seek clarification from Law Society on that point.
Yeah.
And I would read that clarification with interest. But I am fairly clear that it would, in the first instance, rest in the pursuer.
Sure.
But with that explanation, that I believe that a personal statement by the pursuer to adduce that they held that reasonable belief would be something that would be possible for the pursuer to do.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Mary, followed by Liam.
We heard in evidence, Cosla and a couple of other people that came to talk to the committee gave us a suggestion that a specialist hub of the personal injury court would perhaps be the best place to hear these cases. I'd be interested in your thoughts on that.
Okay, I noted that. Now, that can have attractions in that there's a specialism that's built up. You know, on the other hand, if you're playing devil's advocate, you might argue that a specialism may lead to non-innovation, if you like. If you had it just before your average sheriff court, they may have a different, fresh eye to it. But I do accept that there are lots of arguments in favour of having specialisms. As to the the decision making on this issue, that would be a matter for the Lord President to designate such courts. And I feel fairly confident that the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service will be looking very closely at the official records of this committee in terms of the points made that have application to the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service. So it would, in the end of the day, be a matter for the Lord President. I would just make the point that in terms of the new personal injury All Scotland Court, I mean, it is not the case. I think it was the ABI who suggested that actually all actions would have to be brought there. That's not the case. Actions can be brought in any sheriff court in Scotland, and indeed in the Court of Session, should the threshold be reached in terms of the quantum. So that is something important to bear in mind. But I do think, on balance, specialisms, yes, are helpful, not unhelpful, but this would be a matter for the Lord President to designate such a court.
Yeah, I mean, given the comments that you made in an earlier question to me about giving additional support and additional training to lawyers and solicitors and courts, there may be some advantages to this. And I suppose we have no idea how many cases are going to come forward. We have no idea the burden on courts. So it may be the case that specialist hubs may be beneficial in dealing with the cases as we go forward.
It may be, and I think, again, as I say, I feel fairly confident the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service will be looking closely at the work of this committee on this bill and will be reflecting on suggestions that come forward. I wouldn't like to abrogate the rights of the Lord President to decide what happens in the court system, because I might get into trouble, I don't know, as a minister. But it is important to point out that it would be for the Lord President, but I note what the member says on that point as well,
okay,
and we'll
thank
consider
you.
That for me.
Liam
MacArthur.
Thanks so much. Can I take you back to the issue of the court's discretion we touched on earlier in relation to the questions around 17C? In terms of 17D, obviously there are still a couple of instances where court would have discretion to reject a case where there wasn't likely to be the prospect of a fair hearing or the retrospective application of the law could result in substantial prejudice. You will have seen from the evidence we've received there are a number of witnesses expressed some concern that with I think a lack of guidance around or clarity around how that discretion might be exercised, there was a possibility with, as I said earlier, a more small c conservative approach by the judiciary to use that discretionary power in effect to apply the time bar by other means. Is that a concern that you recognise? It comes through from the discussions that you and your officials had with witnesses, and what consideration was given to whether or not more guidance around how this discretionary powers might be applied could be beneficial in allaying those fears?
Yeah, the Section 17D substantial prejudice test brings us back to the onus then falling on the defender to show that actually proceeding would be of substantial prejudice, not just theoretical prejudice, or that it might be likely, as Eleanor O pointed out, but rather that there would be substantial prejudice, and that furthermore, in the consideration of that, that the court must balance that with the pursuer's interest in proceeding. And it is only after that further balancing consideration is made that, in terms of presumably the gravity of the substantial prejudice that they would find in favour of the defender, and that the action should not indeed proceed. And this again has been included after very careful consideration to reflect this delicate balance that we need to strike in the drafting of this legislation to ensure that we feel we have the best chance possible to defend the integrity of this bill should there be any subsequent attempt to undermine the bill. And we feel that including this mechanism on the face of the bill, so that the fair hearing, which applies anyway, but including the fair hearing test and the substantial prejudice test, that we have reflected the balance where we need to also recognise the defender's interest in legal certainty and finality of the law. And we have recognised this through this mechanism on the face of the bill and that we then would have the courts so proceed. I mean, this would be the test on the face of the bill, so it wouldn't be something that the courts could ignore. This would be the test that would be set clearly in this mechanism, and setting a mechanism we feel is actually very helpful for all concerned, for the integrity of the bill, but also for the courts and for the defender.
I think you yourself quoted the Faculty of Advocates earlier in suggesting that the bill provides a reboot, and that the expectation of the faculty certainly was that you would see a change in approach because of that switch in terms of where the balance currently lies. But nevertheless, is there scope? Should that not be the case? Should the future case law suggest that, in a sense, that access to justice is still being denied because of the way that this discretionary power has been applied? Is there an opportunity to provide further guidance around that time to reinforce the kind of central message of the legislation?
Yeah, I think there are different views about whether we should be amplifying this on the face of the bill. And, you know, one view, I guess, is that, you know, this may provide further clarity. Another view is that this could actually cause confusion, because what is the guidance to be? I mean, there are so many possibilities here of substantial prejudice that we may be, if we set forth only some of those, even if it's a non-exhaustive list, nonetheless be setting off, you know, if you like, red herrings that the court will go down, and to the exclusion perhaps of consideration of other matters. So I'm not really convinced that setting forth any particular non-exhaustive list of guidance here would necessarily be helpful from the perspective of the integrity of the bill and, in fact, even the defender's interest on the issue you raise of whether this then is changing the balance so much that actually it will be the case that this will be a test that will always be met, and therefore to the detriment of the interest of the victim overcoming this obstacle to get their case in court. And again, I would say that this has been crafted very carefully to ensure that we are demonstrating that we are seeking to meet the test, if you like, of restrictions on ECHR rights and Article 1, Protocol 1 rights by looking at the legitimacy of the aim of the legislation, looking at the proportionate nature of what we are setting forth, and looking at whether there were any other alternatives. And in terms of the proportionality, we feel that this mechanism on the face of the bill is proportionate in light of these considerations of the integrity of the bill. And it is, this area is full of very difficult challenges, and we do feel that we have struck the right balance here. And it will be the court, in the end of the day, that will have to make this consideration. And it will be, the onus will be importantly on the defender to show that this is substantial prejudice, not theoretical, not that prejudice may be likely, but that they would suffer substantial prejudice. And there must be then a further balancing of that, even if proven, with the pursuer's rights to proceed with the action. So we feel in all circumstances that we have embedded within this mechanism on the face of the bill this balancing of the respective rights of the pursuer and the defender.
And in terms of the exercising of that judgment, we've heard some concerns from the representatives of the personal injury lawyers that, in a sense, that determination occurs at the very end of proceedings. There are those who believe it should happen right at the outset. In a sense, one can see the benefits all round for it happening earlier on in the process, in terms of reducing the impact on the individuals involved and reducing the cost in terms of taking forward the proceedings that ultimately fall due to the exercise of that discretion. What's your understanding of where that judgment around prejudice and a fair hearing is likely to happen?
Yeah, what I would say to the member is at the present time, in terms of considerations of the applicability of the limitation rule in any exercise of discretion, that doesn't always happen at the beginning. That consideration is a matter for the court in the instant case, so that consideration can happen further down the line, and it would be the same for the substantial prejudice test. It would be a matter for the court to make the determination at the point at which, in the instant case, it felt it was most appropriate to do so.
So in terms of the balance of cases, one would expect more to happen later on in the process than at sort of preliminary hearings?
It's a very difficult question to answer unless I'm missing some.
Yeah, well, I mean, I suppose actually in terms of the financial memorandum, it is material, and that the later in the process this happens, obviously the financial implications in terms of the tribunal service, notwithstanding your point about full cost recovery, is going to be higher. and therefore some sort of judgment must be made about where it's reasonable to expect that judgment to be exercised in the majority of cases.
No, I think the short answer is that it would be for the court, because obviously these are very difficult issues for the court to determine in terms of a fair trial and substantial prejudice. And it might be for a particular case that it's not until you have heard all the evidence that you know which evidence is relevant. And as I guess an example could be if a witness would have died and the defender claims that there's an unfair trial because the witness would have died, but actually if the evidence shows that witness is actually not relevant, then that perhaps would not be an unfair trial. So there could be cases where actually you need the full picture of the evidence to be able to determine what's fair or not, or the level of substantial prejudice. But it would be for the court.
I mean, I appreciate that, but I think back to maybe one of the points Douglas Ross was raising earlier about sort of expectation management of survivors, who many of whom have gone through a fairly tortuous process, even to be at the point where they feel they may be able to take forward a case. The longer that case proceeds before there is a ruling on whether or not there's substantial prejudice, the more damaging it could be if ultimately that discretion is exercised in a way that to them appears no different from the exercising of the time bar, the limitation on time bar at the moment.
The difficulty, though, in providing any sort of dirigist guidance would be that actually, as Eleanor has pointed out, it is wrapped up in the facts and circumstances of each case, and you could make a call actually which would not be helpful perhaps to the pursuer in a particular case. So I think we do have to recognise that the courts are master of the facts, and have, you know, we're not changing the whole law of delict and how courts go about reparation cases. We are seeking to change the applicability of the limitation period and the balancing that we feel we have to conduct within that process. So I think it would be it would be very difficult to come up with a rule that would be appropriate in each case, because in each case, the instant case will determine at which point these considerations are most relevant, and that, I feel, we have to leave in the hands of the courts, who are masters of the facts.
Okay. Minister, in your opening statement at various points, as you've been giving evidence, you've made it crystal clear that court action is not going to be for every survivor. And you listed some of the things in the policy memorandum, the child abuse inquiry, the survivor support fund, and the National Confidential Forum. However, you omitted to refer to the Apology Act, which some of the survivors had suggested would be a remedy that some people would choose as opposed to court action. Now, this, as you know, was granted royal assent on February last year. The expectation was it would be enacted by commencement, would be in 6 months' time. That was under your predecessor. Could you maybe advise the committee where we are now with the Act?
Yes, Convener, I mean, the Convener will be privy to some of this information because we've been in discussion in terms of the implementing regulations surrounding the Act, the Apologies Act. What arose during the passage of the Apologies Act, and it was my predecessor, Mr. Paul Wheelhouse, who took that bill through at that stage, and it further to representations received, it became clear that for some bodies, the processes of the bill were not appropriate and they wanted to be accepted. And a commitment was made by Mr. Wheelhouse, I think at stage three of that bill, that indeed would be proceeded with. And it is the proceeding with that has brought up other issues, because other bodies have come forward to say that actually they are in the same position and have these discussions have involved other bodies who have made that point. And so we had been in discussion with the convener, given the convener's direct interest in the matter, we were not able to reach agreement on the best way forward, but we feel that we have an obligation further to the commitment to Parliament that Mr. Wheelhouse made and the good faith discussions that we've had with these other regulatory bodies, that we must proceed in good faith and act on our commitment to Parliament. So we hope to bring forward these regulations shortly, and these will come to the committee and there'll be, I'm sure, a full discussion, and I'm happy to come back to the committee at that time to answer any questions that the committee may have.
If I could just press the minister on this, the commitment from the previous minister was to look at health regulators, and seeking clarification from the Cabinet Secretary now further to our discussions, then I have in front of me a letter which says that he's pleased that the passing of the Act meets the recommendations of the Scottish Right Commission in their action plan for justice for victims of historic abuse of children in care, and gives merit to the apology law in full. He then goes on to say, a commitment was made to Parliament to ensure no unintended consequences for health regulators would be something that was a result of the bill being passed. Can I seek confirmation that the FERGA regulators you are talking about are merely the health regulators? These were excluded from the provisions of the Act because of the duty of candour. Can I seek that assurance today?
The exclusion is not on the duty of candour, but I mean, the member will be aware further to our discussions on this matter that actually in the course of these discussions about the health regulators that would be in the same position as the two specifically referred to at the outset, being the GMC and the NMC, that other health regulators came forward. But in addition to that, there are two other regulatory bodies that have come forward to say they're in the same position and to treat in good faith. We must recognise that. And we will be bringing forward regulations that reflect that good faith discussions that we have had and that we are required as a responsible government to have. We will bring forward these regulations, we hope, quite soon. And obviously the Justice Committee will want to
And these
have
two
a
other
discussion.
Bodies are?
As the member will be aware from our previous discussions, the Teachers' Council
General Teaching Council
and
for
the
Scotland.
Social Services Council. These yes. were the ones that we discussed in our meeting. So
that's good to get on record and perhaps pursue further for another day. John Finney.
Thank you, Convener. Minister, the committee's not been party to these discussions, and obviously we look forward to this coming forward. Are you able to say the extent to which, if at all, it will impact on the issue we're dealing with here, the historic abuse? Because what we have heard is that people do welcome the opportunity to receive an apology, and, you know, not everyone wants to go to litigation.
Yes, the specifics are to deal with the particular procedures of, I think, from memory now, 8 health professional bodies and their procedures, and these 2 additional non-health bodies, so there's 10 in total. And it will not impact on the civil remedy to be provided through this legislation. And it isn't really caught up with the duty of candour, and it is difficult, as the member says, because the member has not been involved in these discussions. I think 3 discussions I've had with the convener on this subject. But he can rest assured that the issues raised in the limitation childhood abuse bill are separate from these discussions.
Okay, thank you.
For another day, Minister.
Indeed.
In the meantime, can I thank you and your officials for presenting today and for this worthwhile evidence session, and I suspend to allow the Minister, her officials to leave, and for witnesses for the next item to take their seats. We will have a 5-minute suspension. Agenda item 7 is our second evidence session on the Railway Policing Scotland Bill, and I refer members to paper 7, which is a note by the clerk, and paper 8, which is a spice paper. I welcome to the committee today the panel before us, which is comprised of Nigel Goodband, National Chairman, British Transport Police Federation, Chief Superintendent John McBride, British Transport Police Superintendents Association Branch, Michael Hogg, Regional Organiser, National Union of Rail, Maritime and Transport Workers, Callum Steele, General Secretary of the Scottish Police Federation, and Alistair Burney, Staff Representative, Transport Salaried Staff Association. And we'll go straight to questions from members. Douglas Ross.
Could I first of all ask the Federation, you state that you sincerely hope the views of those most affected by the integration of BTP in Scotland into Police Scotland, namely the officers, will be given due consideration in the final decision for integration. Do you think that's happening at this stage, and are you concerned that the consultation on the proposals from the Smith Commission to devolve powers of BTP to the Scottish Parliament only focused on one area, i.e., you know, taking BTP into Police Scotland rather than other options that were available? And I noted on page 9 of your submission, you said that it was more about engagement but not consultation. So could you elaborate further on that?
Yes, well, as a federation, we believe right from the outset that the question being asked by the Scottish Government was how best to integrate BTP into Police Scotland. The question wasn't should it or shouldn't it happen. There was a number of options put by the British Transport Police Authority, and clearly, in our opinion, the Scottish Government dismissed all options bar one, which is total integration. What we've seen so far from the process that we've been involved with is no evidence that supports any benefits, or indeed that the Smith Commission itself recommended full integration. Yes, it recommended it should be a devolved issue, but there was no recommendations for it to be submerging BTP into Police Scotland, and that was very concerning from our perspective. So we feel right from the outset that there wasn't acknowledgement of what our views were, what the views of the police officers that we represent were, because the simple decision is that it is only one option, and one option of full integration.
Could I go further into your submission to the committee, and in particular looking at the command and control element that you have, and if you could explain how that seems to operate very well at the moment. And last week, Parliament was presented with a report from Audit Scotland into the Field I6 project for Police Scotland, which is all about IT systems for the single police force. That £46 million project concluded that our officers in Scotland are currently still using out-of-date, inefficient and poorly integrated systems. What concerns does that give you as a federation, and perhaps maybe some of the other people on the panel, about the BTP coming into a force that currently has such an antiquated and potentially dangerous system that's not working for our officers currently?
I can only comment on what the British Transport Police have in place at the moment, and that is one seamless command and control system. It has one crime recording system and a reporting line through the train drivers and the victims. So the process that's there now works, it's successful. Yes, there's been teething problems with the introduction of the new niche that's been implemented within BTP, but that is a positive from our position that niche is a better command and control system that we've had previously. It is working, it's proven to work. And yes, there are concerns when you read within the media regarding the failure of the I6 project within Police Scotland. And it does draw concern that you possibly will have two command and control systems potentially deciding between the two, where does the victim sit? Did the victim get on a train in London, but then suddenly report a crime in Scotland, and then there's this debate of, well, where did the crime occur? Was it in England? Was it in Scotland? And it could throw in difficulties, unnecessary difficulties, in our mind.
I wonder if anyone else...
Yeah. Come in, Camilla. First of all, I'd just like to thank the committee for this opportunity to share the views of the BTP branch of the Superintendents Association. Actually, having one joined up command and control system, you know, whether it's in Police Scotland or the Legacy Forces or in BTP, as an operational commander and a senior leader, it is an imperative in railway policing, absolutely. And if I could just give you an operational example, we are preparing right now our plans for the forthcoming World Cup qualifier, Scotland versus England. And in a BT context, as is just now, being able to see fans and train loadings, whatever those fans might get on, whether it's in Birmingham, Manchester, Aberdeen, Inverness, for all the fans that will travel, as an operational commander, is really important. And actually, post April 2019, as the operational commander in any new railway division, clarity on where my resources are in that railway division so that we can deliver for the public and the train operators would be vitally important to the operational optimum at which we would be able to perform.
Thank you, Convener. I mean, I suppose to some extent that the question about what might be happening if the BTP comes into Police Scotland on the command and control systems is probably not one that we can do an awful lot to help on, because we would need the assurances or the response from the police service itself. But from a logic and common sense perspective, and I have to say I have experience of the BTP system, having been foolish enough to leave a bag in a train, and through the skills and good offices of the diligent officers of those in the Haymarket depot, was able to recover it the same day. I would find it odd that there was any suggestion that, with all of the difficulties that the Police Service of Scotland has, that if and or when it takes over the BTP functions in Scotland, that it simply switches off what is currently there. It seems to me inherently logical that the service would continue to maintain the system that works, in line with the assurances that were given previously from Bernie Higgins that there's going to be a dedicated transport policing system maintained within the Police Service of Scotland. And I can't imagine that anyone within the IT departments of the service is currently sitting there devising a cunning plan to get rid of something that works and replace it with something that might not. In fact, there might even be benefits for the wider police service itself to look at what the BTP currently has and see if that could be a model for utilising within the Police Service of Scotland. So it's not just a case of where there might be disbenefits. I actually think there might be benefits in the opposite direction. And I just can't envisage, for all of the reasons that have been laid out by Darren and Chief Superintendent McBride, that the service would simply turn those kind of things off. But ultimately, all we can do is speculate, because we're not in a position to answer that question.
Michael
Hall.
Having a fit for purpose system in place is absolutely crucial as far as the staff are concerned. You know, let's say, in order to have the correct information related to the BT police is crucial, you know, let's say, and that, in our view, from a staff perspective, is fundamental. You know, let's say, we need a fit for purpose a system that's going to deliver the correct information. So that's a concern from a staff perspective, whether you be a driver or where you actually be a guard on the train. You know, so it's crucial that we actually get the communication correct, and it's crucial we actually get the proper system in place that needs to be fit for purpose.
Thank you. Anyone else? Mr. Brown?
Although today I'm speaking primarily as TSSA representative for staff, I can comment on the capabilities of our IT system. Niche, the command and control system is actually integrated to crime and case management as well. So the area commander has just alluded to the benefits of live incident management. I can also explain the great advantages of crime recording and management and the case management as well, which follows, meaning that there should be no inquiry gaps, no victim service gaps, and a common standard throughout the force throughout Scotland. Comparably, Police Scotland, I do know, have at least 8 different crime recording systems, at least 8 case management systems, none of which speak to each other. So the advantages are huge in our system. This is to the benefit of all. And going to the Police Scotland current IT systems would be a disadvantage.
Could I just come back on that point? I was going to come to it later in the evidence, but since you've raised it now, could you also further explain the difference between recording in Scotland and recording in England? Because the way I've understood from the evidence, at the moment that's not a problem because BTP can record the crimes. But am I right in saying in Scotland we do it from one point it's recorded, and in England it's recorded at another point, and there is a potential for loss of evidence and an inability to actually record crimes in as efficient a manner as you're currently doing?
Yeah, that's essentially correct. England and Wales obey the Home Office counting rules and crime recording standards, whereas in Scotland, including the BTP Scotland, we obey and have been measured to an excellence degree the Scottish crime recording standards. One difference is the locus of crime. Our crimes generally are transient, with a start and end location, sometimes across the border. BTP consider the end location to be the location, certainly to where to begin and allocate crime inquiries, for common sense reasons at least. Whereas Police Scotland do not, they consider the start location as the location of that crime. We're talking on those instances where the exact location is not known. For example, something happens en route between England and Scotland. You can't exactly say where this crime occurred. We will record the end location and begin our inquiries there. Police Scotland would consider the start location to be the location of that crime. And that could mean an English crime, Scottish crime, different legislation, different procedures, different inquiries, and so on.
And finally, for this point, and I have other issues I'd like to come back on if we have time, but Callum Steele mentioned ACC Higgins' evidence last week about having a dedicated railway policing unit within Police Scotland. Can I ask the panel, particularly the Federation and Chief Superintendent McBride, did you take reassurances, if you saw last week's evidence session, about the 2 or 3 weeks additional training that would be given to all officers coming into Police Scotland that would really upskill them enough to be seen as dedicated railway policing officers? And also, can I ask about the element that officers need to have with the personal track safety certificate, and how we will be able to have officers in Scotland who, if they're not trained to the same level as BTP officers, if they don't have the personal track safety certificate, what implications are there for that as well?
The evidence given by Mr. Higgins, personally, I wasn't reassured, because I don't generally believe Mr. Higgins has thought the consequences of having every officer in Police Scotland trained, because the training doesn't come free. There is a massive cost to that training. Every officer within Police Scotland, if they intend to police the railway or go anywhere near the railway, will have to have personal track safety. If you enter into an environment that's so dangerous without that knowledge and that understanding and that expertise of knowing where you can stand, where you can walk, what direction the travel is, etc., then you're putting yourself in a very dangerous situation. I'm sure Mr. Steele from the Police Federation of Scotland would, you know, be really concerned if his members were suddenly patrolling along the tracks with no certification and no guarantee that if something happened to those officers, what support would they get from the organisation? It is a misconception that that you can simply just train an officer to work within that environment. Yes, they have the initial training, but it's biannual. You have to keep having a refresher course. It's a pass or fail course to recertify to be able to continue working in that environment. And you have to carry that certificate with you when you're there. So they will need that. So there will be a continual cost for every single officer working within that environment. So
Mr. Higgins's comments, I don't think personally they didn't give me reassurance, because there's a massive cost implication to that as well.
Thanks, Convener. Just a few points. The danger of the railway, as Mr. Goodvant has stated, is there and ever present. BTP officers do undertake the track safety training and refresh regularly. I personally think those are skills that have to be used on a regular basis. Otherwise, the training will wane over time. Police officers are bombarded with training in a whole range of areas. And I think if officers weren't using track safety training and having that familiarity with the dangerous operating hostile environment that the railway is, then people could be put at danger. We go through that safety training because it's necessary from a health and safety point of view to protect our officers. But actually the end game in all of this is to make sure police procedures can be honed and carried out in an improved way that reduces any disruption to the public. That's why we do the PTS. The benefits that flow out of that are all geared towards the public and trying to get the railway, when it is stopped, recovered sooner from criminal acts or from mental health episodes.
Anyone else like to add? Mr. Michael Hall?
From an RMT perspective, we obviously would support people being properly trained to actually be anywhere near our railway. That's absolutely crucial as far as we're concerned. I did see the evidence last week, and we don't necessarily accept the position so far as the proposed merger is concerned. Our position is quite clear from a trade union perspective. We do not support the proposal that's on the table to merge the BT Police with Police Scotland. And from a trade union perspective, we're certainly concerned, and we've certainly not ruled out the option of taking the industrial way action in order to retain the BT Police on a railway, because we certainly take the railway people being safe and the passengers using the trains in Scotland being safe. And we've actually embarked upon a campaign in Scotland, and it's called Safer Scottish Trains. And part of that campaign is retaining the BT Police on our actual train, because as far as we're concerned, the BT Police and our Safer Scottish Trains are inextricably linked. Therefore, we see the need and the requirement to have the BT Police on our actual trains, who are actually properly trained, and having the staff with a personal track safety certificate is absolutely crucial, and anything else is pure nonsense as far as we're concerned.
Thanks, Convener. I think to some extent my response is going to be reflective of what I said previously, that it's probably not going to be helpful to try and second-guess or interpret what was said by ACC Higgins. And us members of this committee will know I'm not in the business of unnecessarily defending senior officers in the Police Service of Scotland, or indeed the police service itself. But I didn't take ACC Higgins' evidence to mean what Mr. Goodband has said. Certainly to my mind, he made it very clear that every officer, whilst they were going to receive an additional 3 weeks of training in terms of aspects of the policing of the railway, that the specialist railway policing elements would receive additional training over and above that. And I think I'm sure that if someone writes to him to ask his view for clarification, I'm sure he would confirm that is exactly the case, that it's not just going to be 3 weeks for everyone and then you've got a tick in the box for policing in the railways. I agree in terms of the general issues about how dangerous the railways are, because trains are bloody fast and they can scare the bejesus out of you if you're not used to the kind of environments in which you're working. And I appreciate that, having come from a smaller provincial force where the relationships and the reliance on the local officers and BTP officers is not what it is in the central belt with multiple tracks and all the rest of it. But I have worked, not in any great extent, on railways. I have recovered bodies from railways. Now, I appreciate again that working in single lines where the train has come to a halt is also entirely different to elements of track safety associated with passing trains and all the rest of it. But I just don't conceive it feasible. I find it incomprehensible that the service, whatever the service is going to be it BTP in its current state or some hybrid state or the transport service within the Police Service of Scotland, would put any police officer working on the railway line without them having the appropriate track safety requirements. Because the old adage of if you think health and safety is expensive, try an accident, would come bearing down on them with a hell of a rate of knots. And let me tell you, I would be right at the front of the queue knocking lumps out of them for even suggesting trying to get that done. So in terms of the general evidence that ACC Higgins gave about the raising of the awareness and additional trainings for the Police Service of Scotland, I think it's a very good thing. I also was pretty comforted as far as I could be without working through the detail of what we're going to be looking at in absolute sense, that when it comes to whatever specialist resources are going to be reserved for the railways, that they will absolutely receive the adequate and necessary training that they need to do their job.
Okay. We've got a number of supplementaries from members following the line of question from Douglas Law, so I'm just going to take them in order, starting with Rona, Ben, Mary, then John. Rona.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, it was to ask Nigel Goodband, it's relating to your opening statement, if I could have your response to evidence we heard last week from Chief Constable Crowther of BTP. I totally accept that the Smith Commission recommendations as taken forward in the Scotland Act 2016 bring about the devolution of the functions of the British Transport Police in Scotland. There is no doubt about that, and we totally support it. I wonder if I could have your reaction to that.
I totally agree with that statement. What I said at the beginning was we have seen no evidence within the Smith Commission that states that it should be a full integration of BTP into Police Scotland. We support and understand the Smith Commission and the devolved matter, and we don't dispute that. What we are in dispute with is to assist the Scottish Government in achieving that aim, there was a number of options put forward, and only one, in my opinion, option has been considered throughout this process. And that's where we had concern.
And what was the preferred option for you?
Well, my personal preferred option would be for BTP to remain as one national police force policing the railway environment. However, if there was a will of the Scottish Government to take more ownership and more control over that, then I see no reason why British Transport Police officers cannot remain within the British Transport Police, but there is a badge renaming of the Scottish Transport Police, for example, but they remain part of one national police force. And it's interesting to hear that there is a view within Scotland that they are trying to create and have accountability for policing for one national police force. Well, British Transport Police is a national police force and it's a very successful police force. And I do hear the comment regularly amongst my members who saying, are they simply just robbing Peter to pay Paul to achieve the same aim? So it is concerning that how there is no evidence to date that we've seen that shows that there's any benefits, that there's any failings of the British Transport Police that would suggest there should be a change. We've proven after inspection that the way we police the railway, our policing model, is successful. So why would you want to change that? Again, another saying is, if it's not broken, why fix it?
I don't think anyone's suggesting there's been failings on the behalf of British Transport Police or questioning its excellence. I think the question is, why would it not be integrated into Scotland's National Police Force?
Because it's ultimately you're severing the services of a police force, i.e. the British Transport Police. As I say, we are a national force, and suddenly to take Scotland and the British Transport Police of Scotland away from the British Transport Police, you're actually severing and, for me, creating an unnecessary border between two police forces.
Anyone else have a view?
I totally concur with what my BTP Federation colleague has said. We do not understand why you're trying to fix something that is not broken. You already have what you need. It appears you want to break this up, the BTP in Scotland, simply
I
to...
I don't think that's ever... It's not a question of breaking it up.
Ma'am, that's the feeling. And you're going to recreate it in some other form within Police Scotland. You already have this. You can have what you want at no cost, basically. Option two. Sorry, I just don't understand that. Neither do staff.
All right.
Thanks. I think if I could just quote Mr. Higgins, I don't think it was the last session, I think it might have been at the round table. Mr. Higgins said, this can be done, however, it's going to be massively complicated. And I certainly wouldn't disagree. And the BTP superintendent's branch will work to help the Parliament and this committee understand all the risks as we see it from our professional point of view. I think there, in trying to replicate the service that has been sort of highly valued, and ministers have said that repeatedly, they highly value the service that the men and women of the BTP in Scotland do, then you, I suppose, going down the proposal route as is, we are extracting something that has been immersed in a railway policing culture for over 150 years in its current format for about 67 years, from which has been born significant innovation in our approaches to hone police procedures, necessary police procedures, that have been honed in such a way as to still fulfil their very need, but actually do it in a way that reduces any disruption that might be caused by those police procedures. If you look, there's five areas generally that cause criminal disruption to the railway in the country: trespass and vandalism, cable theft, level crossings, graffiti, and mental health and deaths on the railway. Each of those areas that take place in a very hostile operating environment, BTP has looked at how we investigate those things and innovated in many ways to ensure that we can do it and cause the least amount of disruption to the train operators and thereby to the travelling public, so that the travelling public can have confidence that the services will get them to work daily, on time and consistently, to get people to business meetings, to family celebrations, without the railways being disrupted any more than is necessary. That, I think, is what is at risk here. That specialism that has been built up over many years. Now, I will work to try and replicate that, and replicate, because that's what I hear people saying. We want it to be as least, you know, at least as good as it is just now. But I think in accepting that journey that we may be on, there's going to be, if I quote Mr. Higgins again, it's going to be massively complicated, and we should accept that there is likely to be a level of disruption or diminishing of that service as we transition into the Police Scotland Railway Division. And the risk is all of that good that we do. Disruption on the railway just now, criminal disruption, costs over £5 million. If you add in the suicide and the deaths element, you very quickly go up to over £13 million. Now, what we do know from our data across the country is that when local police are involved in some of these investigations at the start, it takes at least 50% longer to fully investigate and get the service recovered. So there is likely to be, I would suggest, an additional cost there. But we will work and we will share our practices as we are right now with the Scottish Government and their seven work streams. We are working to share the way we police on the railways with Police Scotland colleagues to try and build that specialism. But it's born out of a culture over 150 years and an attitude and a leadership that allows the men and women in the division to problem solve more with the railway than with police colleagues because of the environment that we work in. And through that innovation, arrive at solutions that deliver for the public.
Okay, any other comments?
Ben, followed by Mary. We're still in supplementaries, but a good line of question.
Thank you, Convener. I think there's a real collective determination to maintain a transport policing ethos, no matter how Parliament chooses to proceed with that. And I think it's important to bear that in mind. And contrary to what Douglas Ross said in a similar vein to what Callum Steele said, my interpretation of the evidence last week from ACC Higgins was that there would be a maintenance of a specialist railway policing entity within Police Scotland, together with extra training in transport policing for all new recruits that then go through Police Scotland's training programme at Tully Allen. I would have thought that given we have that collective determination to maintain a transport policing ethos and indeed to enhance the transport policing offering here in Scotland, that such extra capacity within the police service would be something that would be welcomed by the panel.
Yes, Mr. Goodband.
Well, an example of such is has recently occurred in Holland, and unfortunately it didn't work there. And what we have now on the Dutch railway is private security, because the train operating companies actually use private security to police.
But I don't think that's anything like being proposed here with respect.
Well, you're making a suggestion that the transfer or the integration into Police Scotland provides a wider specialism, a wider resource. And I would contradict that in saying Holland is an example where it didn't work, where the same perception was given when that decision was made. In a similar scenario, Lord Arris himself has conducted a review regarding the terrorist threat to London. And in London, we have the largest police force in the UK. And part of Lord Arris's recommendations was that the Metropolitan Police should adopt some of the good practices of BTP. So I go back to my original point when I answered Mr. McKay's question, was why try and fix something that's not broken? We provide an excellent service, and there is no logic or no reason or no evidence, more importantly, why suddenly that service that's being provided now, today, should be transferred to another police service.
If I may, Convener, I think as Rona Mackay said, there isn't a perception here that British Transport Police is broken. The approach, as I understand it, is to enhance the offering that's available for transport policing in Scotland by utilising the economies of scale and the other extra specialist services that Police Scotland would bring to a transport policing offering here. But I think as well, it's for clarity with reference to your points about Holland and London, again, the proposal, as I understand it, is that a specialist railway policing entity within Police Scotland will be maintained, those specialist skills will be maintained and enhanced, but also, on top of that, extra capacity will be created by creating a greater awareness through training, through the programme of Police Scotland. That's certainly, so the idea that it's a contraction of the offering in terms of railway policing, it seems to me to be a misrepresentation. It's actually about enhancing the capacity within the service.
No, Convener, thank you.
Mr. McBride.
I think the enhancement is an interesting area. The crime on the railway in Scotland is at an incredibly low level. It's probably one of the safest environments in the whole country. If I said to you that your chance of being an assault victim or suffering any violence on the railway is one for every 275,000 passengers, then you may get an idea of the criminality that, or the levels of criminality that we are dealing with. And whilst enhancements are always welcome, I think there's always a decision that will be made in prioritisation over where the crime happens. Now, I suppose our history and our planning and our policing plan development absolutely acknowledges a key role of staff who work on the railway, frontline staff. In fact, if we talk about some of the innovation that I mentioned earlier, a number of years ago, we brought about what's called the DNA spittle stick that allows, and it's been rolled out further than the railway onto buses and other public transport, it allows anyone who's spat at a disgusting, disgusting assault to take a sample. We innovated there and we are able to get that analysed, and very often we will get a successful hit. But there's priorities to be made there. If we are dealing with around 5,000 crimes in the railway, that is absolutely one of our priorities. And I'm really pleased to say that we have less than 100 assaults on staff every year in the railways in Scotland. It's too many, but it is at a low level, as crime is generally. The challenge for us is actually keeping it that low. So those enhancements are welcome if staff are trained. I think at the round table, Mr. Hanstock and Mr. Higgins talked about collaboration and talked about, I think, a moment, the phrase might have been, when our backs are to the wall, when there is serious disorder, we will absolutely come together. In our planning for events, we plan together with Police Scotland, as you would probably expect. However, if it comes to tasking specialist resources and our backs aren't to the wall, so we're not in that heightened serious disorder mode, I would look to use BTP specialists, whether it's dog handlers, working at heights teams, public order officers, because they understand the operating context of the railway. They understand that some of our police procedures can add to disruption on the railway, and therefore our procedures that have been adapted and honed are understood by those specialists. And we wouldn't always necessarily turn to bring people in, if you like, from other forces, because that level of knowledge isn't there just now. But we hope in the work that we progress, and we share our training with Police Scotland, that they will see the way that we train and the way that we operate and our culture of policing on the railway. But no one, I would hope no one would misunderstand the railway environment in Scotland is an incredibly safe environment. We have about 48 crimes for every million passenger journeys. That was in 2012. We've got it down now to 45 crimes for every million passenger journeys. It's an incredibly safe place, the railway. And our task that we are charged with is to try and keep it thus. And we do that through our specialist skills and our specialist training and being immersed in a much bigger body that looks to innovate. Innovate so that we can provide solutions that keep the services running and delivering for the public.
Thanks very much. Thank you, Camille.
Okay, another supplementary. I've got two more and then I'm going to move on to our main lines of questioning, which will be with Stewart. So, Mary and John.
Thank you, Convener. Just in relation to specialist support that British Transport Police offer, I think it's worth pointing out the work that British Transport Police have done in reduction of metal theft, an 87% reduction in the last few years, which has a massive knock-on impact on the wider nail network. And I don't know if you want to comment on that. But the other question I wanted to put to you was, British Transport Police tend to be visible, and I'm not by any means saying that Police Scotland are not visible, but there is a perception of visibility amongst British Transport Police officers, particularly at, I suppose, antisocial hours. You would expect to see officers in stations late at night and early in the morning to prevent and tackle antisocial behaviour or any incidents that kick off on trains. And passengers have an aspiration and an expectation that they will see officers. So I wonder if you could perhaps comment on what impact you think could possibly happen if the merger was to go ahead. Do you see a pullback in visible policing?
Sorry, is that
yes,
to me?
Yes, if you could, if you don't mind starting.
I don't. I know there is a danger that BTP and in the future railway policing officers could be pulled away. Mm. And in fact, I think the submission that we put into the committee explains that point, why we would think there is a danger that could happen in some abstraction. But if I could just deal with the late night disorder, and I am really pleased that you have seen that visibility. We've actually just spent the previous 12 to 18 months looking at our demand profile and how we meet that. That's across the force, but here in Scotland as well. And on the 9th of April, we're about to change the rosters for officers and staff. Never popular, but actually we're doing it because we feel as if we're slightly out of step in terms of where the main demands are. Now, the railway is, in my view, the economic backbone of the country. It contributes so much. Now, we could talk about during the day with commuters and having that confidence of getting to work, or we could talk about the nighttime economy and people going into our larger towns and cities, enjoying the theatre or pubs or cafes, whatever it happens to be. And actually, we can pull in the railway staff there who have to deal, as you said, with perhaps some of the less savoury characters who take to the trains of an evening. My officers are out there to absolutely bring that confidence to the railway staff, because if the staff aren't on the trains and don't have the confidence, then the trains are unlikely to run. 28 years in the railway police have absolutely taught me that. And the public won't travel in on late night services either, or more importantly, travel home after they've hopefully enjoyed an evening out with their friends and spending some money and putting it into the economy. So that's what I would say. If you want me to say more on the late night disorder and abstractions, I think it's actually covered in the superintendent's branch submission. If I could just talk briefly on metal theft, I could actually talk at length on metal theft, but I'll save the committee that. The phenomenon of metal theft, in my experience, was first identified by the British Transport Police above any other force in the country. And we saw it because we saw the impact that it was having on trains and public service and people getting into work. We saw the disruption that was being caused. And we worked closely with Network Rail and train operators to devise a plan that would help overcome that. But actually what you saw very quickly was that metal theft was going much wider than the transport network. And it was a supply and demand, and it was economics because the price of metal was going up around the world. But it was starting to affect critical national infrastructure, local authority housing stock, faith buildings, a whole range of areas across ultimately communities, but affecting businesses. And BTP have led a number of national campaigns against this. The first one was with the help of the Home Office and a £5 million grant that brought about some legislative change. And of course, if committee members will know here, we have done something similar in Scotland through £600,000 from Transport Scotland grant. And we have encouraged, engineered, collaborated across critical national infrastructure with utilities, with other police forces, other law enforcement agencies to bring about, I think the figures you quote there are the railway figures. Actually, 52% reduction in metal theft across Scotland has been brought about by the leadership that BTP have shown in that campaign, and the way we have galvanised other law enforcement agencies, local authorities, utilities, to better protect their assets, more enforcement targeting metal thieves, working with scrap metal dealers and new regulation, and the Parliament and officials and ministers to change the law. That's the contribution that BTP have made around metal theft, which I think has led to that reduction.
Okay, thank you. Does anyone else want to comment?
I think it's perhaps in the vein of what the area commander's just said, that those mutual metal theft operations resulted in generating many crimes, some of which were off the railway, but dealt with in entirety by BTP, meaning they were detected and reported positive crime statistics. Those were all transferred to Police Scotland, so they actually have the benefit in their statistic. We are integrated in the common aim of justice in Scotland.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Hawke?
Having a visual presence at the freight yards and the network railway yards is absolutely crucial. You know, like say, my members have certainly advised me that seeing the BT police visit those locations on a regular basis is absolutely crucial. And the link between the BT police and the staff is absolutely crucial, because the BT police obviously they know the staff, they, they know the terrain of the railway. So that's absolutely crucial. In terms of the actual merger between the BT Police and Police Scotland, again, from a staff perspective, a trade union perspective, we can actually see the BT Police expertise and knowledge being actually lost if the merger went ahead. Potentially, the BT Police would actually be swallowed up as a result of the Police Scotland resources utilisation. If you take, let's say, Edinburgh Waverley and Glasgow Central, Glasgow Queen Street, you know, let's say, if there was an incident taking place of antisocial behaviour within Princes Street, and we had the BT Police within the concourse of Edinburgh Waverley, then bet your bottom dollar, then the BT Police would be expected to actually deal with that antisocial behaviour activity and Princes Street, therefore losing that expertise, that knowledge in terms of dealing with any forms of assaults and antisocial behaviour taking place, whether it be on the concourse at the stations, Edinburgh or Glasgow, or, God forbid, on their actual way to trains. We certainly get a lot of information coming to the trade union about verbal way assaults and physical way assaults, which is a big concern for us. We're actually engaged with Transport Scotland in conjunction with ScotRail and the BT Police about the possibility of using body cameras in order to actually address that issue of antisocial way behaviour and physical or even verbal way assaults. And what's coming over loud and clear from my members up and down the country, keeping the BT Police expertise and the knowledge and the presence of the BT Police on our railway is absolutely crucial. It's crucial and it's fundamental.
We're now moving on to our main line of questioning. I won't have time for any more sorry, John, you were on this list very briefly.
If I may, I should declare a membership of the R&T parliamentary group, and it's not very often I would take a differing view from Michael. In relation to this, I share his view on the retention of a specialist service. It was to go back to a point that Mr. McBride made earlier, and maybe just an opportunity. Maybe I heard it wrong, Mr. McBride. You weren't inferring that Police Scotland would deploy officers other than risk assessed, and that risk assessment would clearly show the requirement for that additional training.
Sorry.
You talked earlier on about the need for specialist training, and it almost an inference that there could be people deployed who have not been given that specialist training.
Is it back to the track safety competence?
Yes, yes. Uh-huh.
Yeah, so I'm not actually sure that the point that I made, or that you're sort of quoting me on.
Let me rephrase it. Given the contractual requirements, never mind the legal and moral requirements, no one would be deployed. No police officer, regardless of how badge, would be deployed in that way without having the necessary training.
That would certainly be my best and professional advice to Police Scotland colleagues, okay, that they should not do that.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, John. Right, Stuart followed by Alexander, patiently waiting, and then we've got Mary Fulton and Mary.
Thank you very much, Kamina. I just wanted to talk about interfaces, which has come up. There appear to be something like 40 to 50 trains cross the Scottish border each day. The UK, London in particular, has passenger trains going to the Netherlands, to Belgium, to France each day, and freight trains are coming from Spain and Germany on a regular basis, and indeed we've just had the first freight train from China has just arrived in the GB network. So clearly, and the numbers of vehicles involved in that appear to be greater than those that cross the Scottish border. And it's worth saying at 12:15, there had been 7,393 trains operated in the GB network and 766 of them in Scotland. So at the moment, there's an interface between 766 trains in Scotland, policed by the BTP and general policing. There's 40 or so across the border.
in relation to the way in which interfaces with Netherlands Spoorwegen, with SNCF, SNCB are managed, and how they work with BTP and railways generally. Does that actually work? Because I appear to hear the suggestion that it couldn't be made to work across the Scottish-English border, but I haven't hearing it's causing huge problems with France, Belgium, the Netherlands, and other jurisdictions that are connected by train.
Who would like to take this one? I'm rather fearful.
I think it was Mr. Goodbrand who first raised the subject of interfaces, but I could be corrected.
I'm sorry, Mr. Stevenson, but I'm not in possession of any facts regarding the policing of the railway in Holland, other than the fact that there was the decision to take.
I heard the point about policing in the Netherlands Spoorwegen network. That's not my point at all. My point is we have trains crossing borders,
yes,
to other jurisdictions. And one of the issues that was raised earlier was that having a different jurisdiction in Scotland from England would be a major problem. And I'm just wondering if you could tell us about the problems between London and Paris, London and Brussels, London and the Netherlands.
Well, I've got no evidence to answer that particular question, and I don't think that I've suggested for one moment that there would be difficulty in cross-border between Scotland and England, because we prove now that there isn't a problem. What we suggest is, and what we're drawing inference from, is potentially due to a different command structure, a different crime recording system, a different communication system between two different forces, there could potentially be a problem. But what I'm not suggesting now, there is a problem between Scotland and England. In actual fact, quite the reverse. It's a successful policing model that works now, and hopefully it will continue to work in that way.
On the 17 return journeys there are for passengers a day between London and Paris, who records the crime?
I'm not sure the answer to that question. I'm sorry.
So it hasn't been of such a character as to come to your attention?
No.
So cross-border, at least in that one particular instance, has not been an issue?
Not that I'm aware of.
There is always the opportunity, if you want to provide further evidence at any point after today's session, if there's something you're not aware of and want to go back and check, the committee is happy to receive it. But I think we really need to move on. We've got the point that Stuart Stevenson's made, unless anyone's got anything substantial to add to it, Mr. McBride.
Just very quickly, if it helps the committee convener, the example that is used is a much more controlled environment. It is a port with all the port controls. And I'm not sure the levels of crime, but in terms of crime, it would work exactly the same way as we've described here. It would be, if you like, the end station destination. So crimes that are coming in to St. Pancras, it's an international port, would be recorded there. For reasons that were given by others earlier, you have the victim, you can get statements, you can start off the inquiry. But it's a much more controlled environment. I don't know the crime statistics for the Eurostar, and that's the operations of that. The trains that pass between the Scotland and England border, as I think Mr. Goodband said, it works effectively just now. I suppose what the proposal will bring in is almost like dual controls, and we're asking two organisations to think in completely different ways from what they have done hitherto, and how crimes would be recorded or how incidents would be dealt with, and their competences they cross the border or don't, as the case may be.
Right, I think we'll move on. Alexander, followed by Mary.
Thank you, convener. Gentlemen, one of the benefits that we were given for creating Police Scotland was that there would be specialist policing across the whole country, and that there would be a seamless transition for the employees' rights and conditions. That wasn't quite the picture we have today. For your own organisation as you move forward, ensuring that there are rights and conditions for employees, we're advised that it should be as seamless as what happened with Police Scotland. Now, it's an interpretation whether you felt that was a seamless transition. I don't believe that the members and the employees of Police Scotland saw as a seamless transition. I have major concerns about how this could be managed and how it could be maintained, retained and sustained for individuals and employees of the British Transport Police as we go forward. I'd like some views on that.
Yes, Mr.
That actual point is a major concern for the British Transport Police Federation, because the officers of the British Transport Police have dual status. I think you've heard already that they are employees stroke police officers, but what they're not is Crown servants. Now, in Police Scotland, the transferee amongst the eight forces was Crown servants to Crown servants. To date, we don't know, and we haven't been shown, how or what the legal mechanism is for a transfer of an employee to a police service who are Crown servants. So it is a major concern. I know Mr. Matheson himself has sent a letter to myself to circulate amongst the officers in BTP Scotland, and we hear the term triple lock guarantee. Mm-hmm. But the terminology that's used in the letter and indeed the memorandum policy is that the ambition is the aim where possible. So it, in my mind, it doesn't give a triple lock guarantee, and it really still continues with that level of uncertainty for the British Transport Police officers. What exactly will their terms and conditions, their pensions, look like when they, or if they transfer into Police Scotland? So it is a major concern also for ourselves.
Mr. Hogg, followed by Mr. Penny.
Just briefly, you know, from a staff perspective, you know, let's see, bearing in mind, let's see, we don't represent the BT Police. The employees are not our members, but certainly from a staff perspective, you know, let's see, terms and conditions are absolutely crucial. Let's see, from an RMT perspective, any attacks on the terms, conditions, pensions, or railway passes, we would not hesitate in taking industrial way action, issuing the ballot papers. And certainly from an RMT perspective, we stand shoulder to shoulder with the BT Police Federation in terms of their members protecting their terms and their conditions. And I think it's not been unreasonable to actually have a guarantee of their terms and their conditions being protected going forward.
Mr. Burney?
Yes. Staff and TSSA members obviously are actually in fear now of the proposed integration. They can't see what's coming, for sure. They don't find any comfort or reassurance anywhere. And it feels like we're being pushed towards a life and career cliff edge where you will either be pushed or jumped, and we have no idea what the landing will be like. Initially, two-pay was mentioned and discounted, understandably. A version or form of two-pay was mentioned and discounted, again, understandably. And the latest mention was of Cabinet Office transfer of staff or similar regulations. That would be between, you'd be remaining within the same employer, that's not the case here. You'd be remaining with the same pension fund, that is not the case here. So I have to report that there is fear amongst staff about what might happen in a number of ways. One major fear, actually, is we could not remain with TSSA, we believe, once transfer had been completed, and we'd be with a union organisation that doesn't understand the lead-up to this or our pay and conditions anyway. Most staff who have options will take them. Please do not think that the numbers of staff you expect to transfer will transfer. That will not be the case.
And that is one of the main cruxes about the numbers that we are looking at, because the information that we've been given assumes that there is a transfer going to take place of a number of individuals, and that's the quality and the skills and the package that come with that. Yes. But in reality, you believe that that is going to be much more diminished than it would be because of the fear and because of the anxiety that is being created because of the situation and the way going forward.
Yes, that's accurate.
Thank you, Convener.
Callum Steele.
Thank you, Convener. And in response to Mr. Stewart's question, I think it's probably important to make a couple of small points. One is that I would never presume or assume to speak for members of support staff in terms of how the transfer from their former forces into the Police Service of Scotland went, but certainly from a police perspective, given that terms and conditions were, well, certainly meant to be, but they were by and large universal, bar one or two local nuance, that resulted in very little difficulty whatsoever. And whilst I understand why Mr. Goodburn made the reference to Crown Servants, we're not actually Crown Servants in Scotland. It's very common shorthand that translates wrongly north of the border. It might be angels dancing on the head of a pin, but in truth, that's not the status of police officers in Scotland. But there are clearly issues in terms of transferring what are employed police constables into those that hold an office of constable. And certainly from preliminary examination that I've undertaken on the arrangements that exist between Cabinet Office and how those relate to the 2P principles, I don't see them as being insurmountable. Currently within the Police Service of Scotland, we have officers that have a variety of different terms and conditions based upon when they joined and what their particular arrangements were. I suspect we have very, very few that are left that are entitled to our rent allowance. We do have a large number that are entitled to transitional housing allowances. We also have officers that joined. In fact, I know we do have those that are entitled. We also have a very small number of officers, actually directly responsible, down to Mr. Finney, who secured very bespoke arrangements based on the promises that they were given before they were due to start in 1994 versus those that they were actually given when they started in October of 1994. And we have those that are in different pension schemes, both the what is known as the 1987 pension scheme, the 2006 pension scheme, and also the 2015 pension scheme. And if and or indeed when the decision is taken to take the step to take the officers of BTP into the Police Service of Scotland, then I know that one of my responsibilities for looking after what would soon become my members would be to engage in the most proactive of terms with the British Transport Police Federation, with whom we have nothing but the best working relationships I could describe in any event, to make sure that we understand all of the nuances of what apply to the differing elements of entitlements that exist for police officers across that range, to make sure that they are transferred into the Police Service of Scotland. And whilst I know it will not necessarily be a clean and simple thing to do, the nature of bringing people into any organisation is always going to result in some kind of differences along the line. And I suspect at some point, as happens with all organisations when they evolve over time, is that you get closer to something that looks and feels very similar to everybody, rather than having different numbers of people on different elements of entitlement, as indeed is currently the case in the police services now.
I'm conscious of the time. I'd ask questions and responses to be as succinct as possible. I'm going on with the main line of questioning, and I hope at the end the supplementaries that some people have indicated they'd like to ask, we will have time to ask them. Mary followed by Fulton.
Thank you, Convener. My main question was very similar to Alexander Stewart's question, because I wanted to ask if you've been given any long-term guarantee about the terms and conditions, because I asked the question last week about the terms of conditions of staff upon transfer, because it's my understanding TUPE does not apply. And Assistant Chief Constable Higgins said to me that it was he had been assured that the Scottish Government were working furiously to ensure that the current conditions of service of all British Transport Police will be honoured. And Mr. Foley said that it was his belief that that was the intention. I take it the witnesses today have been given no guarantees that that will be the case.
We definitely haven't been given guarantees. And I very much welcome Mr. Steele's stance that he would be supportive of the officers if they transferred over to Police Scotland. But there's a slight stumbling block, and that is British Transport Police officers are under a contract of employment under the Employment Act. They don't and are not employed under police regulations. So again, it's questionable whether our members can indeed be represented by a police federation that is written within the statute under police regulations, because we exist, the British Transport Police Federation, under statute of the Railway and Transport Safety Act, not under police regulations. So there is,
And I'm not suggesting for one moment that we can't achieve that, but there is a lot of obstacles in the way that nobody understands. It's never been done before. There is no legal mechanism to allow it to be done. Yes, we can use COSOP, but that is no guarantee to an officer who may transfer a year, 2 years down the line for that to change, because it has no legal binding guarantee for those officers to keep their terms and conditions, their pensions, their free travel in some cases. So no, unfortunately, we don't have that guarantee.
Yeah, and I suppose my concern is that over time there will be a natural erosion of terms and conditions. If British Transport Police move in with their enhanced set of terms and conditions, over time that will be naturally eroded, because I accept the point that Callum Steele makes that there are a number of different legacy arrangements across the Scottish Police Force, and different officers have different enhancements. But as officers leave, those enhancements are not maintained, so there will be a natural diminishment, and I am concerned that the same would apply to British Transport Police.
Mr. Steele.
Thank you, Convener, and it's specifically in the point made by Mary Fee in the question of whether the position is actually one of enhancement or one of betterment. And I'm not entirely sure that position has actually been answered. It's certainly, I think, a bold statement to make it as a position of fact. There are certain elements where the conditions of BTP officers are certainly better than those of Police Scotland officers, not least in respect of the entitlements for travel on the rail network. But again, certainly from my understanding, those vary depending on when people join the BTP. But in terms of general terms and conditions, I think it would be a bold step to state that there is a risk of deterioration for anyone coming into the Police Service of Scotland, because at this point in time, I would like to think, through no small effort down to the work of the Scottish Police Federation, amongst others, we have significantly better terms and conditions than many other police officers in other parts of the UK. And there is a danger of trying to get into apples and oranges here, but I certainly know that in many elements of the conditions that apply for the police service in Scotland, they are superior to those that are replicated in England and Wales. And I do know that to a large extent, but not exclusively, the BTP conditions of service are more closely aligned in general terms to those in England and Wales than they are in Scotland.
Mr. McBride.
Thanks, Convener. If I could just turn to the substantive points, I think, in the question that Mr. Stewart asked and Ms. Fee around the terms and conditions. It's undoubtedly true that this has caused significant angst and uncertainty among staff. Staff who we expect to go out every day and police the railways in the really successful way that has been acknowledged, I think, by this committee, ministers and others. And that angst is driven by complete uncertainty over the legal mechanism and what guarantees that legal mechanism may well bring. So if I could just use an example, and I know Mr. Goodband has asked for this question a number of times from officials and others over the legal mechanism, but certainly some of the staff in the BTP in Scotland have said, why would it be the 284 of us? Why is the wider organisation not, if I could use the phrase, at risk of going across? Because we don't know the legal mechanism. And why would it be us, necessarily? Now, that comes from, if you go back to what I said before, a culture of specialism, a conscious decision to join a specialist railway police force. And people are saying, why would I want to transfer into something that is much more generalist? The pension arrangements are quite different. A funded scheme, not an unfunded scheme, with different accrual rates, different contribution rates, different benefits, different opportunities to retire, different indexation start points. Massively complicated, if I could quote Mr. Higgins again, massively complicated. But BTP are working with the Scottish Government and Police Scotland in the work stream around terms and conditions to try and unpick this and see how it might, if you like, transition across. But it's undoubtedly extremely complicated, has caused great uncertainty and angst among the people who serve you in the BTP in Scotland.
Just This point of information, members will remember last week that Mr. Foley undertook to give an explanation of why 2P didn't apply. He's since got back to the clerks and referred the explanation to be made by the Scottish Government. So just as a point of clarification on that. Right, Fulton followed by Mary.
I'd like to ask the panel, it might be best that Mr. Goodband, directed at Mr. Goodband, where are the majority of resources and assets for BT situated, firstly on a UK basis and then on a Scotland basis, maybe also for Mr. McBride?
Well, each division, and there's four in total, have centralised specialism, i.e. crime scene investigators, crime scene managers, detectives, specialism within the CID, reactive, proactive. And then there's the centralised force specialism, which is in London at force headquarters in a case of a major incident, a murder investigation of that nature, then resources to support the already resources within the divisions will be deployed from our force headquarters.
Something right?
I think, like most other police forces, we are corralled or concentrated around a number of hubs, as Mr. Goodband has just explained. In Scotland, the majority of our resources, like Police Scotland colleagues, are in the Central Belt.
Okay, the reason why I asked that line of question, it was actually coming back to an earlier point from yourself, Mr. McBride, but you'd spoke about the significant cost increase if Police Scotland are involved at the start of an investigation, say, or an incident or whatever. What circumstances would there be where Police Scotland would need to be involved at the start of an incident, and how often does that occur?
I just missed the start of the question there, that I had said there would be an additional cost increase.
It was an increase, I think, 50% was maybe what
you
said.
I think what I said was, we know that criminal disruption on the railway costs X amount. We know if local police forces attend first, it will take normally at least 50% more time and therefore additional cost to getting the railway recovered and people moving again.
Oh, so the 50% was more than time. Okay, so that was my misunderstanding. But how often does that happen? How often across Scotland would you say that an incident has occurred on the railway that the Police Scotland are first to respond to?
So if we use the figures for this year, Police Scotland attended first to incidents in the railway 1.8% of the time. So two incidents in a week out of about 250 incidents. So about 1.8% of incidents, Police Scotland turn up first.
Okay. And what sort of incidents are they most likely to be?
I think probably right across the spectrum of criminality. So it could be trespass, vandalism, antisocial behaviour, disruption at stations, incidents on trains, and they may be called to intervene. So it will be a wide spectrum of things that they'll be asked to... Level crossings.
Yeah, OK. So in terms of when Police Scotland... arrive at the scene, or when BTB arrive at the scene, you would accept that there is joint up working arrangements in place between the both services?
Yeah, absolutely. Yep. We collaborate on a daily basis. I think I said earlier, we plan together for most big events. Police Scotland are planning for the policing of the event. We are normally always planning for the mass transit system and thousands, tens of thousands of people moving to go and see whatever the event or concert or sporting event happens to be.
Okay, and do you think that, sort of just to finish off, convener, do you think that the confidence that we heard in last week's panel from John Foley, for example, and Bernie Higgins, which we've heard about from other members, The confidence that we heard from John Foley and Bernie Higgins last week in relation to the merger being successful, do you think a lot of that has came from how current operations are, and Police Scotland obviously being already involved in the incidents and feeling that the merger can work successfully?
I don't know that I picked up the confidence, if I'm honest. It might very well have been that, and I may have missed it.
Well, I've got quotes here. I think other people had actually mentioned them earlier. But just
trying to get everyone in.
Well, John Foley said, we're extremely confident we'll deliver the merger successfully. And Bernie Higgins said, I am confident that the transition would occur and it would be done in collaboration and partnership. So, you know, part of the quotes. Yeah.
And I think I'm probably on record, both for the Superintendents Association, actually, and as the Divisional Commander, to say, if we are talking about policing and perhaps the difference between arresting someone in Central Station or Waverley Station or Aberdeen Station, as opposed to arresting them in the High Street, there is no difference. You know, police officers are police officers and they'll be able to do that. Where I think the specialism, the cultural difference in a specialist police force comes is in the discretionary effort that we bring and the discretionary benefit that we bring to the travelling public, to the train operators, and actually the wider Scottish economy. Allowing service recovery by honing our police procedures and ensuring that they do not disrupt any more than is necessary. Getting the service back up and running so that people can get to their work or business meeting, I think is where we really add value. I'm not convinced yet, although we are working with Police Scotland to share our procedures, that will be available on day one, on the 1st of April 2019, or actually any time soon after that. I think it could be quite disruptive.
Okay, just very briefly,
just
Mr. Hall.
Just an observation, you know, like you say, Police Scotland would not have the access to our railways if there was a derailment or a collision or any trespass on a railway. If Police Scotland officers do not have a PTS certificate, then they can't go on or near the running line.
Okay. Mary, followed by Liam.
Yeah, it was just really, if I harken back to an earlier point, but actually following on from what Fulton said, because it was in a relation to a question that was raised last week, and it was John Finney that had raised it initially. And I'd had a follow-up one, and it was really about asking how the British Transport Police were deployed across Scotland. And we received the figures back as part of supplementary evidence this week. So you can see that, obviously, the Central Belt is, you know, there's quite a heavy presence there. And I suppose the thing that I find more concerning is just the, I suppose there's less of a presence as you move up towards my constituency. I'm Angus North and Mearns, up around the northeast and across to the Highlands as well. So I suppose in that sense that if we're looking at a specific transport division within Police Scotland where those officers are trained, I feel that that would give me more comfort anyway, that if there was an incident in some of these other areas which aren't so well staffed at the moment, that there would be that at least would be a presence there that were capable of dealing with that. And it's just really to get your comments and thoughts on that.
Mr. McBride.
I would probably go back to what I said earlier. We've just completed the demand review work. And from the 9th of April, we are changing how we look and feel to adapt to the demand. The demand in the Northeast for BTP is primarily football based, with quite a lot of work and effort done with the offshore industry because of some issues that can arise when people come back onshore. And actually some particular trains that come down from the Northeast all the way down to Newcastle that have to be policed right through seamlessly across the border because of the risk of disorder on those trains. I think I also said before the number of calls that Police Scotland, so that's a two-way process. Police Scotland go to some of our calls, I said 1.8%, so it's about two every week that they will attend on average. We receive over 1,000 missing persons inquiries and requests from Police Scotland over the period of year, just to give you one example. In the last 2 weeks, we've received four requests for specialist search capability, trackside looking for evidence or missing people that we supply back in. So it's a kind of two-way process, that. But certainly our analysis of the criminality and the disruption on that line and in the region of the Northeast is causing us to change our staff profile, and not just the numbers that we have there, but the times that they work to better meet that demand.
Moving on.
Another point, and it's not related to that, but it was just, it was particularly for you, Mr. Burney. It was about the staff survey that was carried out and the results of that. I was just wondering how many the staff actually took part in that survey. And I see that 37.5% indicated they would be intent on leaving, some through retirement, but many through an expectation that they think they'll be made redundant post-transfer. And I was really just wondering, I mean, have you been given any indication that that would be the case, that that's what would happen, that these staff would be made redundant?
Yeah, that's certainly the case, we believe. One reason being we've seen the removal, redundancy or of staff in Police Scotland already. We know of their low morale. We want no part of that, obviously. We're safe and comfortable where we are. If we do transfer across, we will be on average £3,000 a year salary less. We don't know where the post would be. And we also note that police staff roles in Police Scotland vary regionally, meaning that the same role can be differently paid and have different conditions depending where it is in Scotland. This is all adding to our anxiety and conclusion that if we have an option to go elsewhere before then, we should go elsewhere.
So can I just clarify then, so where did you, is that somebody from the Police Scotland, is that what you've heard from the government, that so is it just your belief that these redundancies will take place, or have you had, or have you specifically been told that? And also in terms of the salary, you mentioned that as well. Again, is that something you believe to be the case, or is that something you're told is going to happen?
Yeah, we know that's the case. We have checked this out.
With who?
The TSSA, with the respective Police Scotland.
Yeah, if there's more information you can provide to the committee on that, I think that would be helpful and it would allow us to move on. Liam, followed by Douglas. These are supplementary, so if we've got time, we'll do it. John and Ben had said they wanted to come in. Liam?
Okay, thank you, Convener. I might give Callum still the opportunity to come back. I mean, I think, firstly, in relation to confidence that Fulton McGregor was indicating earlier on, we had similar expressions of confidence from SPA and Police Scotland in the run-up to I6, and clearly I think what we need to do is satisfy ourselves that confidence is well-founded. I want to touch on the issue of morale, which is, I think, mentioned by a number of you this morning. I think where any change process is clearly difficult. I think with police in 2026, we have the prospect of a reduction in the number of police officers. And I would perhaps ask Calum Steele what the likely impact is on the morale of officers within Police Scotland. If in order to facilitate this transfer through the negotiations that are coming at the moment, it is felt that they're coming in on terms and conditions that are preferential to those that Police Scotland officers have. And for Mr. Burney in particular, the staff survey referred to has upwards of 40% indicating a feeling that they would be leaving the service through one means or the other. How disruptive that is in terms of maintaining any sort of service at a point of transition, which, as I say, I think all of us accept that any transition, any change is going to be difficult. But the order of magnitude that's been quoted in that staff survey would, I think, give rise to any concern in any organisation.
Yes, thank you, Convener. And I'll get to Mr. MacArthur's questions presently. But I do think it's important, and to some extent I'm going to slightly contradict what I said earlier about speaking about the terms and conditions of support staff. And I suspect that there are Unison colleagues who will be watching this broadcast just now screaming at their television sets. But the harmonisation of support staff terms and conditions in the Police Service of Scotland has not yet taken place in a way that the service would expect. Now, rather than identify that as a problem and something to be feared, I actually think that shows that the 2P principles under which staff came from their former forces into the Police Service of Scotland have actually been adhered to. And the same principles could only apply to police staff or support staff members coming from the British Transport Police Authority into the Police Service of Scotland. So that's not something that would result in a diminution in terms of conditions. It would result in the maintenance of what they currently have under the principles that 2P clearly lay out, at least until such time as you get to the position of harmonisation at some point in the future, because no one can ever have what they had in the past forever. But on the specific issue of the impact of 2026, reduction in numbers and morale. There is a very distinct difference between police officers and reduction in numbers to support staff and reduction in numbers, given the question, the position of redundancy. Police officers, certainly those that hold the office of constable, cannot be made redundant. And as such, the morale impact for those that are losing their job doesn't really exist. It's only for those that are left because people haven't been replaced as a consequence of retirement or through natural attrition. And self-evidently, there is a morale issue if the loss in numbers results in a reduction in capacity and those that are left doing the work of those 400 or so, that certainly that's been floated around just now.
In the sense, if there's a deal to be struck with BTP to allay the concerns that have been expressed today, were expressed at the round table and are very evident in the written evidence that we've received, then in a sense, there will have to be the claiming of some success that those terms and conditions have been protected with the migration of BTP into Police Scotland. And against that backdrop and the context of the debate around policing 2026, surely to goodness that is going to give rise to some degree of, if not resentment, at least a questioning as to why there's this debate happening over here where there's a treatment of officers coming into the force in one way and a separate debate with Police Scotland officers which is happening in a very different and more difficult context.
I don't agree and the reason I don't agree is because there is a fundamental difference between those that hold an office and those that are employed. Now, the one thing that probably hasn't been explored up to now is the question of what happens to those that are currently employed when they hold an office. Do they then maintain their entitlement to redundancy and some of the questions that are associated with that? Personally, I can't see how that is possible. And whilst there are advantages to being an employee, there are also some advantages to not being an employee and the holder of an office. But on that single particular issue, I don't think those two are compatible. There are efforts, in fact, not efforts, there is a provision in the police service in England and Wales where there is a capability to apply for a form of voluntary redundancy, although they don't call it such, I forget the terminology that they give it. No help from my colleagues to my left. No, it's...
30 plus.
Yeah, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. But either way, redundancy and policing does not work. But I see the opportunity for when, because we've deliberately not stepped into the natural territory of the British Transport Police Federation on this. But I see the opportunity that when or if we have these discussions, that the maintenance of the terms and conditions, that those that are currently there, is something that should be quite easily secured, because we did secure some of the protections that would be expected for officers from the former forces. I'm getting there, Camilla, from the former forces in terms of the residency and the positions that could be applied to them in terms of transfer. And it's only right and proper that the same thing would apply for Scotland.
If it's very, very brief, I can take Douglas and then John, but it will have to be very brief.
I'll be brief, and it's just two final points based on the evidence we've received. First of all, on the staff survey, which I thought was interesting, I mean, 37.5% said they were intent on leaving, yet the other 62.5%, it wasn't a ringing endorsement to remain with BTP coming into Police Scotland. They said they cautiously said they intended to stay. So we've looked at morale, but I wonder if we could briefly go round the panel, and I'll have a separate question to Mr. Steele, but looking at the potential for the loss of experience, not just the morale that means these people won't continue, but actually the loss of resources and the loss of experience that we in Scotland would suffer as a result of these figures, if they bear any resemblance to what actually happens with the lack of officers coming forward. And just on Mr. Steele, because he mentioned transition. Now, I think it's fair to say, as part of this panel, he has perhaps been more supportive of the plans than the others. And I just wonder what his view is, and I saw his tweet last week about the evidence given by ACC Higgins and how he was very impressed by it. But ACC Higgins mentioned the luxury of having 2 years to implement these changes. Given the problems expressed with the creation of a single force by the Scottish Police Federation and its members, do you think, even with that luxury of 2 years, in ACC Higgins' words, is this the right time to be doing it? With the uncertainty over Police Scotland, all the problems they still are going through and the problems your members are highlighting on a daily basis, is this the right time to be integrating BTP into Police Scotland?
And if you could be very brief.
Brief, convener. In terms of that very specific question, that is ultimately a matter for Parliament and one under which the Scottish Police Federation will have little control. But I do think it's important to deal with the question of support. The Scottish Police Federation has maintained neutral on this question and remains neutral on this question even now. What I have done in my evidence today is highlighted what I consider to be some of the areas that could work and how the Federation and the service would approach them. And you know, we have not and would not make a position on a body of employees that are not our members. That would be wholly inappropriate. And ultimately, when Parliament makes that decision, then we'll get to that particular stage.
I wasn't casting aspersions to your evidence in general.
Point. If there's anything you haven't added or you'd reflect on and want to add, then the clerks will be happy to receive any clarifications or additional information. Briefly, anyone else want to comment? Mr. Hogg.
Just briefly, you know, in terms of morale, you know, from a staff perspective on train, gate line and at the actual stations, morale's at a rock bottom position as far as the staff is concerned. And we're greatly concerned because we obviously engage with our members up and down the country. And they're greatly concerned about what the ramifications, the implications are going to be for the BT police going forward. And if there's any actual thought of actually taking away the BT police from our railways, then we certainly will be greatly concerned with that position, because I think it's absolutely crucial, important that we actually retain the BT police with the knowledge, expertise that they actually have. That's crucial in order to ensure that we have a safe railway in Scotland.
Mr. McBride, briefly.
Very, very briefly, Convener. I think the demographics for the division, if that is the proportion of the force that is to move across, shows there are somewhere in the region of 30 to 35, maybe up to 40 people who are approaching, if you like, towards the end of their service, if I could put it like that, and who may choose to go. That's the sort of number that you are looking at. I think in terms of trying to retain them, we've talked about the uncertainty. If those people with that service do choose to go, then we would be looking to fill them from within Police Scotland. And therefore, again, I would go back to the submission that I made in writing. That specialism will possibly take a hit right away.
That concludes our line of questioning. Can I thank the witnesses for what's been a very detailed and very helpful evidence session. Douglas Ross?
I just wonder, Convener, we heard from the panel and indeed from members some difference in opinion in very crucial information we received last week from ACC Higgins. Some of us had concerns about training, other members didn't have concerns. Given this is a vital aspect of what we are discussing with BTP integration, can we ask for a full response from ACC Higgins as to what he intends Police Scotland's training for current and future officers coming into a specialist railway division and also all 17,000 officers? And I think we need a full and detailed analysis of that so our witnesses today who have raised concerns and others who think it's sufficient have that information in front of them before we reach a conclusion.
Yep, agreed. We will ask Mr. Higgins for that information. I now formally close this meeting. That concludes the 10th meeting of 2017. Our next meeting will be 21st of March, when the main item in business will be a further evidence session on the Railway Policing Bill. Thank you all very much.